Good morning and welcome to the fourth meeting in 2024 of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee. I remind all members and witnesses to ensure that their devices are on silent and that all other notifications are turned off during the meeting. The first item on our agenda today is to decide whether to take items 3 and 4 in private. Are members agreed? We're all agreed. Thank you. The second item on our agenda today is to take evidence from two panels of witnesses on the Housing Cladding Remediation Scotland Bill, with the first panel taking the form of a round table. And on the panel today, we are joined in the room by Phil Diamond, who's the Managing Director at Diamond & Co., Jocelyn Fleming, who's the Policy and Public Affairs Officer at the Chartered Institute of Buildings, Gary Strong, who's the Head of Professional Practice at the Royal Institution of Chartered Surveyors, RICS, and Kate Swinburne, who's the Associate Director at OFR Consultants. And we're joined online by Alan McCauley, Building Standards Hub Pilot Director and at the Local Authority Building Standards Scotland, and Jim McGonigal, who's joining us from the Institution of Fire Engineers. And I welcome our witnesses to the meeting. I'm going to briefly begin our conversation this morning by inviting everyone to introduce themselves. I'll begin. I'm Ariane Burgess, MSP for the Highlands Islands Region and the convener of the committee.
Hello folks, I'm Willie Coffey. I'm the Member of the Parliament for Kilmarnock and Irvine Valley.
I'm Kate Swinburne. I'm an Associate Director at OFR Consultants. I'm a Chartered Fire Engineer working on a range of different fire safety issues, including those related to external walls.
I'm Marie McNair, MSP. I represent Clybank and Mogai constituency in the West.
I'm Phil Diamond. I'm a Chartered Building Surveyor. Where I own a chartered building surveying practice, and with my co-director Steve Brooker, a chartered fire engineer, we're active in the external wall and cladding issues north and south of the border.
I'm Jocelyn Fleming. I'm the Policy and Public Affairs Officer for Scotland at the Chartered Institute of Building, and my remit is to advocate on the public's interest on all matters related to the built environment.
Good morning. I'm Miles Briggs, MSP for Lothian Region.
Good morning. Pam Gosal, a member of the Scottish Parliament for the West Region.
Good morning, Gary Strong. I'm a Chartered Building Surveyor. I specialise in fire safety, so I'm the Head of Fire Safety for RSS globally, and I'm based in the RSS HQ in London.
Morning all, I'm Stephanie Callaghan, MSP for Uddingston and Vales Hill constituency in Lanarkshire.
Okay, thanks for that. We're now going to turn to questions from members. Please indicate to me if you'd like to come in to respond to a member question or to respond to something else somebody else has said. And for those of you who are joining online, please indicate if you'd like to respond to a question by putting an R in the chat function. And actually, some of our questions are directed specifically to somebody potentially because you've got the expertise on that. The intention that this should be a free-flowing conversation rather than a question-answer session. So let's see how we get on with that. And I'll begin with a couple of questions. So I'd be interested to get your perspective on the fact that the Scottish Government has not publicly consulted on the proposals in the bill, and whether your organisations have had any opportunity to input into its development, and if so, how effective has the engagement been in improving the bill we see before us? And maybe I'll start with Jocelyn, because you're right there before me.
Sure, thank you. I think ultimately, I think this is an important and welcome first step on the road to addressing Scotland's cladding issues. The CIOB is a member of the Scottish Government Cladding Stakeholder Working Group. So we have had some opportunity to feed into basically the wider cladding remediation program of work to date. That being said, as I'm sure we'll get into much later, a lot of the detail is left to secondary legislation. It's not on the face of this bill in its current form. So I think one of our biggest points is that consultation needs to be absolutely robust with industry moving forward as we start to flesh out really important details and implementation. I think we've had a conduit through the Cladding Remediation Working Group. That being said, I think there's certainly room for improvement in terms of the level of transparency and the level of consultation to date. And I think that's one thing that we would urge the committee to do and to ensure is full consultation moving forward with the industry. We highlighted in our response even possibly an indicative timeline with some caveats and room for flexibility that would give us an indication of when we might be able to feed into consultations and dialogue moving forward.
Okay, that's very helpful. Thanks. Phil, have you been able to be engaged?
Yes. obviously, I took 10 or so of the MSPs around a development in North Edinburgh and spent an hour or so sharing a number of points on that. We work on a daily basis with the team in the directorate, and we've been working alongside the directorate in the sort of wider ScotGov now for probably 3-4 years as part of this process. I think our business has an awful lot to offer. We've got a very, very comprehensive database of what is out there, and we've been very active in Scotland particularly. So we've been trying hard to educate as we go.
Great, thanks. Kate?
In terms of, so your question I think was around consultation and engagement.
Engagement.
We've been a bit involved, so I was involved in the sort of initial stages of the single building assessment development a couple of years ago. In terms of the bill in particular, as a business we did respond, but felt like the time that we had to review the detail and it was pretty limited. And we're sort of made aware of it. Actually, I think, Phil, a post that you put on LinkedIn was when we first became aware of the sort of request for comments on the bill. So, yeah, I would agree there's still quite a lot of work to be done. We certainly had quite a few comments on it.
Okay, great. Thanks. Gary, how about your organisation?
Yes, thank you. So, we again, like Jocelyn said, we've been involved in the cladding stakeholder remediation group and other committees like the ministerial working group, etc. So on valuation issues going back quite a few years, actually working with officials here, so which has been really important, particularly with our experience in England around EWS1 and the whole cladding, possible cladding issues, obviously after the Grenfell Tower fire. So we have been heavily engaged with the proposals coming forward. So that's good. I mean, it is really important that there is industry consultation about the proposals going forward around this, so we would welcome that continuing, and particularly I think, you know, our experience in England with the Building Safety Act, and then the raft of secondary legislation that's come out, the regulations that followed that, is that sometimes we've experienced the Building Safety Act, for example, being very, very top heavy in terms of its detail, and that's tripped up the department, the DLUHC department, a little bit. With then secondary legislation coming out to try and define things. So I think, you know, my plea would be that the cladding remediation bill, if it's just going to talk about cladding, needs to be quite high level, and then the secondary legislation, the regulations, then define the detail. Things like, for example, I see in the proposed questions, possibly around PAS 980, the SBA, etc. You don't want to define that too tightly in the primary legislation, because that would tie you up in knots, and then you'd have to change the primary legislation. So our view has always been that make sure that goes into the secondary legislation, where you can change things in the regulations much easier and much quicker.
Okay, thanks. That's very helpful. For now, I'm going to go online. Alan, has building standards? Have you been able to be involved from the Building Standards Scotland perspective?
Good morning. Good morning, convener. Yes, Labs is represented on the cladding remediation working group. So we attend those regular meetings, and our member on that updates that Labs membership in due course. Our attendance at that particular meeting is very much to represent the role of the local authority verifier. And that very much comes into its own when we're talking about the application of building warrant submissions and the verifier assessment of that. So very much keeping a watching brief on the development of the bill, and, you know, happy to answer any questions on the specific role of the local authority verifier as and when they come up through discussions. Thank you.
Brilliant. Thanks very much. And Jim McGonagall, how about the Institution of Fire Engineers? Have you been involved?
Good morning, and thank you for giving us the opportunity to attend today. The Institute of Fire Engineers in Scotland has been very much involved in the whole cladding issue since it's arisen, and been involved in pilot studies and such of buildings that have had external cladding on them that's had to be removed. Regarding the actual bill itself, We didn't provide a collective response. That was down to individuals to respond. But I think we have attended the various meetings from the cladding remediation unit, and have kept very much a watching brief as we go forward.
Okay, great. I'm going to stay with you for my second question, and then come back to anyone who wants to. I won't go around necessarily, but anyone who wants to come in on my second question. So it's about the focus of the bill, the kind of scope of it. I'd be interested to hear what your thoughts are, Jim, on the bill. Should it be solely focusing on cladding remediation, or should it extend to cover all fire safety issues or even all significant building safety matters?
Because I mean, the bill itself is definitely to be welcomed, and it will have challenges, and I think this is one of them. It's very much the case of what is the scope of the bill, and it's been driven by the tragic events that happened at Grenfell and the need to remove cladding that could put owners at risk and have rapid fire spread, you know, across the building. And that's what we want to mitigate as soon as possible, and to reassure residents that may live in these buildings, as well as other impacts that this could have on them. So that part, that's very good, that's very clear. If we're going into buildings then to look at them and to determine are they safe, by its very nature, you will be picking up other things within that building, within the common areas of the buildings and such. I think the reality is no matter what building you go to, if you look at it, you always will find, you know, faults, things that are maybe not quite right. So if you have a fire engineer going out to a building, they're going to pick up other matters. Now, the problem is at what point does these other matters become more of a problem than the cladding itself? And that's something I hear what Gary Strong was saying is, you know, that the detail, it's probably better to follow on. But I think the scope itself still needs to be clarified a bit in the bill so that we can identify what is the typical level of safety that we're looking for. For example, you could end up assessing a building with cladding on it, and determine that it's tolerable. But because of the problems that you've uncovered elsewhere within the building, you think that they are more of a risk. So really, the two parts of it, I do think, have to go together. But the outcome of that, it will delay the process.
Thanks very much. I'm going to go to Kate and then Jocelyn.
I would reflect a lot of what Jim said there. And I think it really depends on, like Jim said, the sort of scope of the bill. So can appreciate that, for example, insurers and lenders may be more focused on cladding. Absolutely not my area of expertise, but I know that's something that they're quite interested in. But just like Jim said, if I go to look at a building, cladding is just one part of that, and that's recognised in our building regulations. For example, we've got 15 mandatory standards, and by pulling out just the cladding to look at it, I have a bit of a concern that prioritises just one issue as being more important than the others. So, for example, if you look around a building that the cladding might have some issues, what if you've got significant compartmentation breaches, or you don't have adequate protection to your stairs, your firefighting facilities might not be acceptable. If we then sort of spend our money remediating just the external walls, sort of what happens to the other provisions, and are you leaving residents with sort of issues that they have to figure out how to deal with themselves? So I think for me it really depends what we're trying to address with the bill. Are we trying to address just cladding and that's fine and then that's clear, but what about all the other stuff? So for me as a fire engineer, I wouldn't consider one issue as a whole. These things are all really interlinked. And I think the single building assessment approach speaks to that, because you do a fire risk assessment, you look at the whole building, and yet you're sort of focusing your attention on remediating the external wall. That doesn't quite sort of make sense to me. I think you sort of need to consider the building as a whole.
Thank you. Jocelyn.
Yeah, thank you. I'd echo the points about, you know, we need to determine exactly what the scope is. I think one of the reasons we're so, you know, strongly advocating for further consultation with the industry is I think we need to proceed very carefully and think about some of what might be unintended negative consequences that come from expanding the scope of the single building assessment. So obviously safety is paramount, and we want to ensure the safety of various aspects of the buildings that we have in Scotland, the homes we have in Scotland. And I'm conscious that I think that the cladding conversations that we're having right now in the single building assessment conversations have maybe highlighted a related adjacent issue, which is we're not really adequately monitoring the safety of other aspects of buildings in Scotland in the absence of certain mechanisms and frameworks and regulations that exist in other jurisdictions. I think we are also part of the Scottish Government's Tenement Maintenance Working Group, and particularly with RICS, a subgroup that's looking at possibly developing a five-yearly building passport that would look very much like a sort of building MOT, as you've suggested, Convener, previously. During those discussions, very difficult conversations have arisen about what we might do if we hand a group of, you know, people in a tenement building, for instance, with mixed ownership, a report that says that they have significant safety issues that need to be addressed right away. In the absence of things like sinking funds or building management and factors, we might be handing people a very real problem to address. And I think we need to be thinking about the possible insurance and lending implications for those people. And you know, we already have a cohort of homeowners in Scotland who are facing challenges in insuring and selling and financing their homes. We need to be really careful about whether or not we might be looking at expanding that cohort. I'm not a lawyer. I'm not suggesting that we are. I think there are very real questions that need answered here. I think colleagues have also raised during the course of these discussions, if we extend the single building assessment much further than what would be within the remit of developers to have a responsibility to pay for an address in terms of external wall cladding, we also then need to think about what that does for the cladding assurance register. So I think it's my colleagues at Homes for Scotland have suggested if 90% of a building's been remediated, the developer has fulfilled their legal obligation and financial obligation to remediate cladding, but the single building assessment has also identified other safety issues, does that building then go on the cladding assurance register because that work's been done? Is that, you know, held off until fire doors are addressed? So I think I'm not necessarily answering you or coming in on where the scope should be. I'm saying there are very real questions that we don't have answers for right now. And I think the way that we roll these things out and the order that we roll these things out in is really important. And we maybe need to be looking at having a parallel discussion about wider building safety challenges we're facing in Scotland, and maybe take this cladding piece as a standalone first step as part of a much larger discussion. So just think to raise additional questions and again, the importance of consultation and thinking about how we roll this out.
Thank you for that. Does anyone else want to come in? Gary.
I think the issue really post-Grenfell Tower, immediately after Grenfell Tower fire, everybody was obviously focused on the combustible cladding issue. And we said really from the get-go that this is a holistic assessment of the building. It's not just about the cladding. And in some instances, the cladding actually isn't necessarily the issue, but there are other more important fire safety issues within some of these blocks which got uncovered as part of the investigation. So to reinforce what Jocelyn was saying, you know, the cladding remediation bill is a good first step. But my worry is the feedback we've had, and we've been at this for six and a half years or so since Grenfell Tower, is that we've uncovered a lot of problems when we started to investigate the cladding as part of fire risk assessments of external walls now under PAS 980. Not necessarily to do with the cladding or even the insulation behind it, but lack of fire stopping and cavity barriers and that type of thing, and then wider issues within the building, such as Kate was saying. And I think that's the issue which I know London Fire Brigade and others have raised repeatedly with us, is that how do we address those issues if you're just going to be dealing with the cladding on its own? So I think, you know, our experience is that it's a good first step, but my fear is that you're going to still possibly be leaving residents in homes that may be unsafe. Mm. The fire risk assessment of the external walls informs the overall fire risk assessment of the whole building. And they go very much, you know, hand in hand, and you can't really have one without the other. So I think that's an important consideration. Obviously, in England, you know, they've gone further with the whole Building Safety Act is addressing structural safety as well as fire safety, because they thought that was important. And it's a question of how far you go with this in terms of the, you know, what the single building assessment standard is going to be. But I do worry if you're just going to focus on cladding remediation just very narrowly about the other issues that might exist in a block.
Just before I bring Phil and then Alan in, just so I'll bring this up with you, but I know others have said it. This is a good first step. Is there a sense from the work you've been doing on the cladding working group and being involved with the Directorate that there's more to come and that this is, we need to do this because there's an urgency to get this moving. I mean, I understand, right, there is difficulty. If you're going to go into the building and assess it in the first place, let's do the whole package. But I'm just wondering if we're just seeing this piece of legislation as a committee and is there more in the pipeline being considered?
Well, personally, I can't say that we've seen that come forward to us. We've only been involved really in cladding, like the cladding remediation stakeholder group has just been involved in cladding per se, with input from lots of us into those meetings, hasn't it? So I don't see so far, unless I've missed something, any work going on further beyond that. I mean, the single building assessment is a great initiative because of the difference in legislation from Scotland to what it is in England and Wales, etc., and the different ownership. So that was a great step forward, I think. It was a great leap forward in terms of doing the single building assessment. But I think in terms of, the overall remediation, how do you move forward? And some of the challenges you might get around exactly what the specification is for the remediation, because it starts going beyond just the cladding itself. That's if you start going into fire breaks and things that are beyond the cladding, beyond the external wall, where do you stop with this? And I think that's where the difficulty you're going to run into with this. And so the devil's always in the detail, isn't it? Every building's different. There's no generic answer to a lot of this. But I do, as I say, fear that as you start getting into this, what do you specify the developer? What's your ask of the developer? Is he just going to replace the outside cladding or is he going to replace all the other issues with the building as well? So I think that's the type of thing that I would worry about.
Yeah, and we also heard last week from developers that there's an issue of doors may have been changed, that, you know, so that's beyond their scope of how they left the building. So I'm going to bring in Phil and Alan, and then Justin, you indicated you want to come back in.
If I could share our experience, we took one property right through the process in Aberdeen on behalf of ScotGov and the co-proprietors. Started the SBA, full fire risk assessment, tendered, remediated externally. And what that threw up was really what the guys are talking about. We have a raft of things that need to happen internally. Solving the external part of it is actually quite straightforward in a lot of cases. But even to this day, we've still been unable to get consent from the co-proprietors to go into the common areas and address a small pile of stuff that was identified in the fire risk assessment. So it's quite tricky in Scotland to go inside a lot of these common areas and common parts and take people's front doors out and upgrade the frames and fire stopping and all that kind of stuff. So it is quite a difficult thing to scope, and it shouldn't focus solely on the external cladding, albeit the external cladding is probably the easy bit to fix. It's when you come to the internals, that's where the detail really is, like compartmentation and fire stopping and systems and services and life safety systems. All of that, the devil is in the detail, like somebody said, with that, and it's very difficult. My slight concern is that if that's all lumped into the one ask, I don't think we'll get anything done in Scotland. I think we have to stream this in some way, break it up, parcel it, acknowledge that it all needs done. But I think if you try to do everything, you'll end up doing nothing, and it slows the whole programme down, and that's a concern of mine. And I think we need to look at a different way of tackling that. You need to do the building holistically, but it's quite often different contractors that would do the internal works anyway, and some particularly in the services aspects. But I think we tie ourselves up in knots and nothing gets done because we're trying to do everything, and there needs to be a way of splitting that process.
Okay, so if there had been the ability in place to go into the building to remediate all those things that you've listed as part of this pilot, you would have gone ahead and done that to see the whole, to demonstrate a whole experience of a building being completely remediated. Yeah, that's that the idea?
Combination of reasons why that's not happened. It's legal, it's consent, it's funding, it's all sorts of things. But I mean, that was a relatively small building, 8 stories high, up in Aberdeen. It took a wee while to get around it and resolve the cladding, and we were constantly trying to address the internal issues as well, but even to this day we've still not been able to get consent to do it. So consent and having the legal ability to go into the internal common parts in Scotland and fix, for example, fire doors, because they're privately owned by a flat owner, so we've got a different type of problem there. That needs to be covered off somehow. But I think if we're trying to do... My concern with this whole process is if we tie those two things rigidly together, we won't get anything done. Okay. We have to start with the major risks.
All right. Thanks for that. Alan?
I think just building a little bit on what Phil was saying there is I think it's important to separate out issues, fire safety issues that are a result of issues with construction, including cladding remediation in that regard, and take that separately from a failure related to the age of a building and recognition that building regulations mature over time and continue to mature over time. You know, when you look at the range of the age of buildings that people live in Scotland, it's huge and, you know, it's insurmountable to an extent. And when you consider the direction of travel and building regulations recently, 2019, we introduced a requirement for two escape stairs in buildings over 18 metres. In 2021, there's a requirement now for suppression systems in all new flats. You know, so I think you have to, this is where the value of the single building assessment and the methodology in there plays a key role in making sure that we use the resources available to address the areas that are critical to life safety proportionately, you know, and recognise that older buildings don't by their nature meet all current building regulations. So I think you need to look at those two different areas separately. Thank you.
Thanks, Alan. That's actually really helpful. It is kind of how do you parse this out and how do you look at something and it's important to find the right way as close as possible to actually be looking at this. Jocelyn, you wanted to come back.
Yeah, just sort of to echo what Phil's saying in terms of, I think your initial question was about this being a good first step. I think to us, you know, looking at the Building Safety Act, it's obviously a huge piece of legislation that we can't adopt wholesale in Scotland for a number of reasons, not the least of which is our tenure system is incredibly difficult. And I know through other parallel work streams, access is a huge challenge. So I think that's how the CIOB has looked at it in terms of a first step of it sort of tackles some of the challenges that arise from Scotland's tenure system. But I think in terms of looking at the wider challenges that have been raised during this committee's evidence sessions, we're sort of saying it's probably a first step because there are also these other pieces we know we need to look at. But also just to sort of echo the points Alan's made about the way that we maybe look at parsing this out in terms of challenges that arise from construction and then the sort of things that happen over time. But just to say our first step was sort of tenure-based initially, but there's a lot more work that we know that we need to do, both in cladding specifically and building safety more widely.
Okay, thanks for that. I'm going to bring in Jim and then Kate, and then I'm going to bring in another colleague with questions.
Thank you. I just wanted to clarify just before we moved forward, when we're talking about all these different fire risks within buildings and whether if we don't address, you know, the fire risks that are encountered in the sort of more common parts of the building or problems with cavity barriers, it's just to highlight that actually the fire statistics in Scotland do not highlight that we have a problem in Scotland and that there's less than 1% of fires spread beyond the flat fire origin. Since Scotland has taken responsibility for the fire stats, there's been no fatalities beyond the flat fire. In the last 10 years, there's a 57% reduction in for flats above six storeys, the number of fires and such. And a lot of this is to do with different measures that are brought into the handbooks. The great work that's been done with it now extending the coverage of fire alarms and detections, you know, to all domestic buildings and such. So as Alan said there, there are additional measures get added over the years to the regulations. And you start off, you've got your single-storey building where you don't really have anything. And as you go up in height in buildings, additional fire safety measures are added to the buildings, your fire-rated doors, your alarm detection, your sprinkler systems and such. There's actually a lot of redundancy to an extent within the fire safety measures within the buildings. So although there may be areas that aren't installed as a manufacturer and such would expect, it doesn't mean that overall the building is putting the residents at risk, and the fire stats do seem to reflect that, although obviously you wouldn't be complacent. And I think Phil is spot on when he talks about when you're tying the two together, it really does slow things up. You know how to deal with that external wall system and such, and to bring in people to deal with it. But it's a whole different case for problems within the buildings. How have they got there? Was it a developer problem? Is it works that's been carried out afterwards? Is it, you know, from residential impacts or whatever? So that is a real problem. And I think the single building assessment by its very name indicates that it's not just external cladding it's been looked at, it's the overall building. And in Scotland, we don't have a fire risk assessment process for the common areas of a building. And so I can agree with Phil, whereas we have the two bits looked at separately or in some way registered separately. And that's where the PASS 9980 process comes in, because it looks at the building holistically. And then at the end, we'll give you a result and mitigation measures and such for how that building should be addressed.
Okay, thank you very much. I'm going to bring in Kate.
I think making a slightly different point. So taking on board the sort of issues with access and sort of who's responsible, developer, or is it sort of issue that's come about over time with changing legislation or expectations? I guess it's worth making the point that for me, I don't think you can quite separate out the external wall in all cases. So for example, it might be that you assess the external wall, it poses some kind of risk, but the only way to address that risk isn't necessarily just remediating the external wall. It might be that there's something you could do internally that will be sufficient to address that risk posed by the external wall. It might be that, you know, money is better spent reducing the risk in the whole building than spending money on your external wall, having a very low risk external wall. But would that money have been better placed addressing a different risk in the building, or would doing something else have reduce the risk posed by the external wall to a tolerable level? So I totally appreciate, like, it's sort of makes sense in some context to separate them out, because it will get work done. I just don't think you can sort of separate them out in terms of, like, achieving an adequate level of safety for residents.
Okay, I'm going to move on. I mean, I think that's been a helpful kind of opening discussion around the scope of the bill and what's in and out. I think there's some interesting bits that have come emerged out of that conversation. I'm going to bring in Willie Coffey.
Thanks very much, convener, and good morning, everybody. I wanted to ask for your views on whether you think that some of the terminology used in the bill is acting as a barrier to faster, quicker progress. Over the recent weeks, we've heard from a variety of people giving evidence, developers included, and they cited things like, you need to define a bit more clearer what we mean by a development and what we mean by premises and what we mean by risk to human life. I just wanted to get a sense from you whether you think these are genuine barriers to progress and speedier progress. And I think, Gary, you kind of mentioned it in your opening remarks as well about let's put not too much of the definition in the primary legislation, but clarify and define more clearly in secondary legislation. So could I maybe come to you first to ask what your views are on this?
I mean, I think it is a good point, because people try to interpret words to their own advantage, and so that's what we've seen happen, right? It is an issue, and hence the reason, just going back to England again with the Building Safety Act, hence the reason there's secondary legislation that try and define some of these things, like what is a high-risk building, and then how do you measure the height even of a high-risk building, right? So there's even secondary legislation around how do you measure the height. So, and I think the difficulty is that if you put too much in, as say, into that primary legislation, then people start to try and twist the meaning of it too much, but you can nail that down, I would suggest, in the secondary legislation much tighter, which is exactly what DLUHC have done in the Building Safety Act. So, but if you're clear that the cladding remediation bill applies to buildings over 11 metres, residential buildings, that's what your definition of premises is, and you put that into the bill, that's what you're aiming at, which is like the Building Safety Act does, for example, then you're clear, so that there's no kind of trying to get out of it by any parties if that's what they choose to try and do, right? So But if you do still have an issue with it, then you can nail it down in the secondary legislation. So that's where I was kind of coming from, is to try and define that tighter. But if you try and define it too tightly in your primary legislation, that's where I think you can get difficulties where, again, you know, with the Building Safety Act, they have had difficulties with the drafting originally, and they've had to bring out secondary legislation to correct what they meant. So I think that's the kind of experience I was trying to portray around that. But your secondary legislation is the key to it, really, because if you can bring that out quickly, and to Phil's point about you don't want to slow this up, you know, there has to be an impetus to keep going with the cladding remediation, because it's, you know, we're coming up to nearly 7 years soon since Grenfell Tower, and there has to be progress in getting these buildings safe. So you don't want to get bogged down too much. And the Building Safety Act is a really complex piece of legislation, really overly complex almost, really, right? So we struggle with it. Those of us who deal with it on a day-to-day basis struggle with it. So you get something which is, you know, 200 pages long or so, and then a raft of secondary legislation. You don't really want to go there, I would suggest. You want to get something moving quickly to get on with it. And then if you find there's an issue, you can bring in your secondary legislation to tighten that up.
Thanks for that, Gary. Any other views on whether the terminology we're using in the bill to define these things is actively giving a barrier to quicker progress? Or do people not share that view? Would even be helpful if you...
My suggestion would be that people that are challenging the definitions and things like that, at this point, we don't really want to be over-analysing this. We need to get things moving. And in Scotland, as Gary says, I think there's time in the secondary legislation to create a glossary and let the wordsmith people define these things in a great deal of detail. But I don't think now is the time for that, and I can't imagine, having read the bill, that it's a barrier for people at the moment. I think that's maybe not the case.
Jocelyn?
Yeah, I think I'd echo the points that Gary's raised in terms of looking at this through secondary legislation and regulation that allows us to be a lot more responsive and flexible where we need to and develop these things over time. I think inevitably we will come across challenges as these things roll out, as we go through this process, and being able to change those things and adapt to them, I think, is really important. My understanding is that the Law Society has, in their response, raised some challenges with definitions and things, and they are certainly better positioned than I am to comment on the sort of legal ramifications of the way that we define things. But I think, to me, all the more reason, as Phil has said, we need to get on with this. We need to start making some progress for people who are living in buildings with problematic cladding right now. So I think, again, welcome first step to allow us the time to really think carefully about how we define things, how we roll these things out. So basically, I would echo the points that Gary's made and Phil as well.
Okay, and online we're going to bring in Alan.
Just to use the Building Scotland Act as an example, we have the primary legislation, which is the Building Scotland Act 2003, but we have extensive secondary legislation, including the Building Regulations document themselves, which is secondary legislation. And that, again, that allows for updating of that document on a regular basis, so that's more efficient. And I think what jumped out for me in the bill is it does appear to be fairly light in terms of defined terms within its section 2728. And the one, and that Gary alluded to, that jumped out, and that was the definition under the SBA of the height of the building. And that's something that, from building standards point of view, is clearly and well defined in building regulations. So I think there is the opportunity to narrow down the definition and define these terms a lot more already existing within the Building Scotland Act, which would be fit for purpose. So we can learn lessons from the architecture of the Building Scotland Act and apply it to the cladding remediation bill to allow it to progress as quickly as stakeholders require it to.
Thank you for that. Thank you. In terms of the cladding assurance register, we also heard some calls at previous committees that buildings should be added to that at a much earlier stage in the assessment and remediation process instead of when the works were completed, which seems a little bit odd to me, but could I ask for any views on that particular point, Phil?
Can I pick that one up? We've got a very healthy database of stuff, of a portfolio in Scotland, and a lot of it's absolutely fine. You know, the cladding assurance register to me could actually start with the stuff that is green and could just go straight into the system. To me, it's quite obvious we should be doing some kind of mass scale portfolio assurance type thing. You know, a fairly simple report, get an army of surveyors, engineers, architects, whatever, go around and capture the basic data, some high-level criteria. You know, probably the first one is height, because in England, I think we've got four different definitions of height, Gary. That's really the first thing to resolve, what is in scope and what is out of scope. But there is a lot of stock out there that is actually quite good, and there's a lot of stock out there that's actually blighted just, you know, by things that aren't particularly risky. So there's an exercise, I think, to accelerate the programme, to get all the good stuff clarified and put into a cladding assurance register, and the more difficult stuff needs to be addressed and added as it goes. But to me, this is a gigantic triage exercise in the first instance.
Okay, thanks, Phil.
Yeah, I think that's an interesting point, actually, Phil, and something that I know Jim and I have discussed separately, is that if we have lots of buildings and we're only putting the ones on there that have been through that single building assessment process, there will be a lot of our existing stock that will either not get on there or will take a long time to get there because nobody's looking at them in particular. So I do think that's a good point. I would say it sort of depends in terms of when should they go on, like what we're trying to achieve with the cladding assurance register. Is it to support sort of lending and insurance, and if so, kind of out with my expertise, but maybe they do only want to know in that case about when a building is adequately safe. But if it's also being used to communicate to people living in the buildings or others about how safe their building is or what the current status of their building is in that single building assessment process, then perhaps it needs to be on earlier. So for me, when does it go on? I think it kind of depends on exactly how that's going to be used and who's going to have access to it.
Okay. Any other views on that, Gary?
Yes, I'm just going to come in on that, because I think our experience south of the border is that you need certainty about all these buildings. And to Phil's point, actually, is that there's an awful lot of safe buildings out there, but people just don't know. And so sometimes you can get a building which is blighted because they just don't know. So transparency about the condition of a building is really important. So all those buildings which are safe, they can go onto the register straight away. And those buildings which have been identified as perhaps might be problematic, but are in the process of going through the SBA and eventually to remediation, etc., there needs to be complete transparency, because the valuers, the insurers, the lenders, etc., will need to know that information. That's been one of the real issues we've struggled with over the past 6 years or so, is not knowing what the state of play is with a particular building. And so I would urge transparency about all buildings. And if you can put it up onto a public register and it's publicly accessible so you can see the information, that helps enormously the industry to keep moving. It helps the insurers, it helps the lenders, it helps the valuers in particular, because they're not trying to search around for information which can completely stall any lending or any sales or purchases of properties.
Okay, thanks very much. Any other views on that, or will I move on to Jocelyn?
I would just echo those points exactly in terms of both transparency, and if we're trying to provide assurance to people, I think one of the challenges with one of the possible challenges, the things we need to consider with waiting until a building's been remediated, is there's a lot of grey area in there for residents and other people that just simply don't have any information until it's finished. So I think we need to look at that very carefully. And I think to Kate's point, it's about trying to establish what it is we're trying to achieve with an assurance register. And I think that will maybe direct when things go on a little bit, is who is this for and what are we trying to convey to people? But I think Phil's made an excellent point about sort of triaging and putting up the information that we do have already. I don't have anything substantive.
Phil?
I don't know where you guys are at with what you think the size of the problem is in Scotland, but we've been running an exercise and we reckon that there's something like 7,000 buildings that are in scope in Scotland. And we reckon out of that there's about 60% of them that, if they were going through a PAS process, would probably be tolerable risk and would be okay. So it leaves you with, you know, a 40% chunk of the portfolio that's going to range from having, you know, a minor problem to a major problem. And I think we could, you know, collectively in the industry get to a position where we know whether buildings are red, amber, green fairly quickly. Mm-hmm. I think we've created a bit of a problem for ourselves with the SBA because it's a binary thing, and it's a red or a, you know, a pass or a fail. So by its nature, everything's going to fail, because there's always going to be something wrong on a building, And if professionals are allowed to exercise their judgment, we've all got a lot of experience. I think that's what we should be doing. We should be assessing these buildings on a different risk basis.
Thanks, Phil. I think somebody's going to come to that question you raised
okay.
there just in a wee minute. I just wanted to finally ask, with the assurance register, it's a snapshot in time. Should it be regularly updated? Should there be a record of any changes to a building that would constitute another assessment? Just some views on that, please, Gary.
Yeah. Well, definitely. I would say you need to keep it constantly updated, almost weekly, actually, because this information is fast evolving, it's live. So I think you need to have that information regularly updated, because people, the professionals in the market that are going to be using it, need to see that it's live and updated. Mm. I think that's really important.
If a building doesn't change structurally, there's no record of any changes.
But in terms of refreshing the register, just making sure that as the information becomes available, it's put straight onto the register. Mm.
Okay, Jocelyn.
To me, this comes back down to the point about what are we trying to achieve with this particular framework. I think what we're talking about currently is a cladding assurance register that looks to provide a list of buildings that have been remediated, at least as it stands, sort of broadly speaking. What I think we're maybe having a conversation about is a safe buildings register, and I think it's important that we maybe don't conflate the two unless we are actually moving towards something that looks like a safe buildings register. So I think that, to me, it comes back down to what are we actually trying to achieve with this mechanism? Is it simply ring-fenced a list of buildings that have had remediation works completed, or are we looking for a longer-term register of buildings that are safe and monitoring their safety? Because to your point, if it's the former, then a point in time is okay. That building's been remediated to an acceptable degree, done, it's on a list. If we're looking at trying to monitor the safety of our built environment overall or our homes overall, that's a very different tool and framework to me. I could be wrong, but I'm wondering if we're conflating maybe two different things that we could discuss at this, and maybe needed.
Yeah, I would agree with that, definitely. It depends what the scope of that register is exactly. I would agree, though, that it does need to be updated, what that time period is, even if it's just confirmation from someone. I mean, EWS1 uses 5 years, doesn't it? Like, at some point in time, I think you would want to go back and say, all the information that's there is still relevant. That could be a short exercise, or it could pick up things that have changed that didn't go through a building warrant process or, whatever it is. But, if you looked at a building and it's been on the list for 15 years and nobody's gone back to say this is still applicable, I think you might start to ask questions about whether that information is still relevant.
Okay. Thank you very much for that. Can you ask?
Jim wanted to come in.
Jim?
Yes, I just want to say it's a good point that Jocelyn raised there, and what is the purpose of the register? I agree. I think it should be updated when any changes are made to the building that can have an impact from a fire safety point of view. But you then get into, well, who's going to determine if any impacts that are on fire safety have occurred? And that then, because in Scotland, as I'd said earlier, we don't, under our fire risk assessment, we don't have any requirement for the stairs, the common areas and such of the buildings to be carried out, which they do down in England. So to me, the register is a way that that we can address that. And so I think that's something that would need to be bottomed out. It almost looks as though it could become like an MOT, as it were, for buildings, where an annual check is carried out to see that the fire critical elements of the buildings are all still in place and all still functioning.
Okay. Thanks very much, Jim.
All right. Thanks, Commissioner. I mean, I just want to clarify there. So I think I thought it was interesting that what Jocelyn was saying. So we've got this cladding assurance register. What's that for? But also, are we moving in the direction of something else, which is a safe buildings register, which is that MOT idea that started to kind of emerge throughout our conversations? And is it useful to conflate those, or is it better to keep them separate because of what we're trying to do here? I'm going to bring in Pam Gosol with questions on single building assessment.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. Last week, witnesses indicated that there was a lack of clarity as to what a single building assessment is, its specification, what it looks like, and what standards it is assessing to. They also felt that until that is adequately specified, the programme will not address at pace the life-critical fire safety issues associated with external wall systems. Would you agree with that? And do you believe the use of PAS 9980 guidance would provide much more clarity on issues that are unclear in Scotland? I'd like to ask Phil first, yeah.
We're certainly lacking some specification and guidance on the SBA. We have developed our own in-house guidance for doing SBAs, but that's basically born out of just normal professional practice that any chartered professional would be engaged in. We desperately need something that benchmarks that, so that everybody's working to the same standard and singing off the same hymn sheet. So that is definitely lacking. The SBAs at the moment are very cumbersome, unnecessarily long-winded. Got a real problem with the binary output scenario. In terms of PAS, we've been working in England now for a number of years. I think PAS definitely has merit up in Scotland. We do actually use PAS assessments. We actually run the two things simultaneously when we do a Scottish property. I'm actually a fan of the PAS process. I like it. I like it because it gives the professional a bit more discretion, maybe not the right word, but you know, a bit more ability to use their professional skills, whereas the SBA doesn't do that at all, because you know, not every bit of cladding and every defect in a building is necessarily going to have a major impact on life safety. Under the SBA process, that would automatically be a fail. Under the PAS, you can use the professional tools at your disposal, can mitigate, you can look at other factors. So I think it's a much more useful tool. It's more mass market. I think there's more people out there available that understand PAS. We've got a big competency issue in the PAS side of things. But given that it's been tried and tested south of the border, I would have thought that was certainly a kilted version of that would be the way forward. We can't just pick up on the English model right away, because we've clearly got issues up here with tenure and different legal aspects that don't quite fit the box. So with a bit of modification, I think PAS could be the way to go.
Thank you.
Gary.
Thanks. So I would say this, wouldn't I? Because I was on the committee that developed the PAS, right? So but we were at pains when we developed the PAS to ensure that it was applicable north of the border. So it wasn't just applicable in England, but Wales, Scotland, Northern Ireland, for the very reason that a fire is a fire wherever it is geographically, and a building is a building wherever it is geographically. But there might be differences in tenure. However, we think that the FRAEW process, which gives you the three, so it's not as binary as the SBA, it's either a pass or a fail, you know, it's low, medium, tolerable or high risk, does give you that professional judgment flexibility to be able to say it's neither one or the other. It's neither low nor high, but it's somewhere in between, and it's therefore tolerable, but you might need to do some other mitigation measures with it. So I would say that the FRAEW process in the PAS works. We obviously have got an RICS training program for assessors, which we train on PAS 980 because we think it is a good document. It's the first version, I would say, as well, and we're learning. It came out January last year or so. 2022, sorry. We're learning around the whole process around this, but at the same time, I think it is a process. It's the first standard that exists. There will be a second version of this at some point in time, but it is something to be adopted. The problem I have with the SBA is that there's no real standard around it. It's quite a brief document, and it is quite binary. It's just that low or high risk, which I have an issue with. I just don't think that really works in practice. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. Anybody else?
I think our position is generally, to Phil's point, we can't wholesale adopt the English legislation for a number of reasons in Scotland's unique context, but I think where there is opportunity to harmonise standards, there is certainly merit in doing so. So I think that's something that we would support generally. And then in terms of where we define or when we define the SBA, I think just to echo points that we made earlier about the merit in considering these things through secondary legislation and regulation later on, so that we've got, as Gary sort of alluded to, the ability to evolve and change these things as we need to.
Okay, thank you. Thanks. I'm going to bring in Kate, and then I think we need to move on. We're kind of in this sticky situation where we're getting a lot of good information, but we're only halfway through and we've only got about half an hour left. So got to kind of balance that. But yeah, Kate, if you come in.
I'll be brief in that case.
Thank you.
I would reiterate the points that, definitely need some more definition around what the single building assessment is. As a business, we haven't been massively involved in that, and partly that is to do around the lack of clarity on the single building assessment. In terms of the PAS, absolutely, to us, the PAS is a framework. So whilst it does reference some English guidance, for example, in it, I don't think it limits you to considering a building in England. I absolutely think it's applicable. It can be applicable in Scotland because it's a framework. It's not a set of prescriptive recommendations or requirements you have to follow. And the other thing is that there is a limited resource of competent people, and an even more limited pool of competent people in Scotland. What I'd worry about is if we have our own sort of Scottish process up here, or we adopt a different standard or something, are we sort of excluding a big pool of competent people elsewhere in the UK who could actually help us with that process? So I think using a process we're familiar with, and like Gary said, I mean, it's the document we have at the moment. It's the best approach we have at the moment. I don't know why we would try and invent something else. Mm.
Thank you.
Sounds good. Pam, if you can ask your next question, and then I know that Alan and Jim, you wanted to come in on this, but if Pam can bring in her next question, and maybe you can speak to that as well.
My question is going to be for Jim, so it's okay.
Okay, perfect.
Good, yeah. John McKenzie, Regional Secretary of the Fire Brigade Union, said that failure to make meaningful progress in removing the cladding more than 6 years on is reprehensible and shows complacency to the point of contempt for those living, working and being educated in such buildings, and for firefighters who would be called to rescue occupiers and extinguishing cladding fires. What is your view on the possible inclusion in the bill of timescales for the delivery of cladding remediation, and how might this work in practice given various technical and industry factors that could delay such work? Over to you, Jim.
Okay. I fully understand the concerns for anyone that, you know, had a building with an ACM on the building following what we've seen in, as I say, tragic events at Grenfell. And following Grenfell, my understanding is that all buildings with ACM on it, significant amounts of ACM were identified, and measures have been put in place, you know, to deal with these, you know, with the developers taking steps to remove it, such as, you know, Taylor Wimpey, Glasgow Harbour and such. So a process has been put in place to deal with, I think there's about 25 buildings were identified with significant amounts of ACM on it. And so a process is in place dealing with those higher risk buildings. And now we're at the stage of dealing with other buildings that have other cladding on it that doesn't meet the non-combustible requirements that we look for now. So I understand where the fire service are coming from, and also the concerns that the residents would have if they're living in a building. And that's why one of the good things, you know, when Phil was mentioning earlier about the register, people will be living in buildings and they have a fear that it may be at a greater risk from fire. And that's why, you know, if you can bring it into the register earlier on, and as Phil reckons, you know, a large amount of these buildings won't have a high fire risk, then it's good to educate the people within that building. But I would go back to what we were saying earlier on about the fire stats. Our guidance and such is different from England and such. And we brought in, there was a high-rise fire back in 1999 down in Irvine where the fire spread to a number of stories, and the guidance changed for that, and they brought in a requirement for domestic back in 2005, I think, for it all to be non-combustible, and brought in sprinklers for above 18 metres. So we are in a bit of a different situation from down south, but I do understand the concerns, and that's why we fully welcome this process and this bill, and to take things forward swiftly.
Thanks for that response, Jim. Do you have any thoughts or anything to add to what was discussed in Pam's previous question around the SPA or the PAS, but really just anything that's different from what's already been discussed?
I think that they've covered it all. Okay. It's a system that's well recognised, and all the pain has gone through in England. Brilliant. And developing.
Thanks very much. And Alan, you had wanted to come in on the previous question, but also maybe if you've got anything to add around timescales.
On the previous question, the point I wanted to make is that while the PAS document is a robust framework, I totally agree with that, and totally agree that we need greater clarity in the scope of the SPA. We just need to be aware that the PAS document references the approved document B, the fire safety regulations in England and Wales, many, many times. And therefore, we need to make sure that any PAS document is suitable for the Scottish system and more importantly, the Scottish mandatory standards. So we won't have to update it in that regard, but as a methodology, totally support it. And I think just on Pam's point around the timescales, I think if the methodology is right and the risks that are required to be mitigated are right, those timescales will be as efficient as they possibly can be. I'm not sure, given the complexity of the process, whether definitive prescriptive timescales may only just raise expectations of the stakeholders involved. If I consider the area we're involved in around the building warrant application process, we will endeavour to assess that as quickly as possible, but it takes as long as it takes, depending on the complexity of the application and the speed of response to any questions that we raise. So I think if we get the methodology and the processes correct, that's going to reduce the process from start to finish and get greater resilience and efficiency in that, as opposed to any sort of definitive prescriptive timescales.
Okay. Thanks very much for that. Now going to move to questions from Stephanie.
Thanks very much, Convener, and thanks to everyone for joining us here today. We've already heard a little bit about tolerable risk, and I think yourself, Phil, you spoke about the fact that probably about 60% of 7,000 buildings kind of fall into that category there. But I'd like to direct my question, first of all, Jim, if that's okay. Because we have heard about the calls for the bill and the associated guidance to actually better reflect that idea of tolerable risks and rather than the low high measures, if you like, and that this could include use of alternatives to cladding replacement where that gets similar fire safety benefits. So I'm wondering if that's an approach that you would support, Jim, and how it might actually work in practice, and then I'm happy for anybody else to come in. Thanks.
Thank you. Yes, I would have to say I'm not a fan of the risk rating within the single building assessment, of just low or high risk, because even if the guidance in the document tells you that if you've got anything in the building that needs mitigated, the building goes high risk, and that means that the majority of buildings that will be looked at, I would think, would fall into that high risk category. And again, it's impact on the residents of these buildings. One, they could struggle to get insurance because they're now regarded as a high risk building, and the fear it gives you that as far as you're concerned, from a fire safety point of view, your building is now high risk, and that's pretty scary. Whereas that's why myself and from what I can gather around the table with my colleagues, as it were, that they're supportive of the PAS process, because it gives you, you get your low, medium and high, and this process has been working down in England. As I say, they've gone through this pain and such, and what you find is the residents want additional information. So many people adopt the health and safety measures, and they've got a clear, they're low, tolerable, moderate, significant, high risk and such, and with information clearly against that. So residents know exactly what the risk is within their building, if it's tolerable, if there's minor things that need to be done. And going through that process, at the end, you'll be told what's wrong with the building and if there is any mitigation measures. And it's very transparent and open. And it also would allow, whether it's housing associations and such, to prioritise buildings, that are at risk. But it gets rid of that suddenly blighting a building by saying it's high risk, when as in the sort of real world, as it were, yeah, it might have things wrong with it, but that risk may be sort of tolerable or just a moderate risk and such. And it's that kind of detail, I think, to reassure residents and insurance industry and such, is what would be needed in Scotland.
Okay. Anybody else want to come in on that? I don't mean to stifle conversation. Now we're kind of ahead of time, so if anyone has a burning kind of different perspective or really wants to make sure we understand something clearly, Kate?
I would just say that, yeah, I largely agree with what Jim says. Low and high risk is far too binary. Our building stock all has a level of risk. Every building has some level of risk. We can't remove risk completely, but making it either low risk or high risk, I think what Jim was saying, the risk... is that lots of buildings will be lumped into that high risk category, and it doesn't allow residents to feel safe, but it doesn't allow us as professionals to sort of focus our attentions on the buildings that really are high risk, right, and maybe leave some that are sort of tolerable or a lower level of risk.
Yeah, it's certainly been something that's come through, I think, in the previous sessions as well, the lack of nuance. Definitely.
If I could just follow that up a little bit, convener, with Jim there as well. I'm just wondering then if kind of part of this is about actually getting all that data together, looking at prioritising the risks that really need to be addressed really urgently, but actually having that information as well so that there can be a wider, more holistic look at actually what issues are coming up and what issues we should be looking to tackle as we're moving forward. Is that the kind of thinking too?
Yeah, I think you've nailed it there. Yeah, it's taking that holistic approach, I think, is all important, you know, because as mentioned earlier, there's lots of fire safety measures within a building, and just because it has something wrong with it, it doesn't mean that the whole building is at risk. And you know, you could have the situation, for instance, you've got the same building in Newcastle and Edinburgh, and one's done by the SBA and the other's done under the PANS. And under the SBA, it would be high risk, you know, in that particular situation, whereas it could be like just a moderate risk that it's coming up with it in Newcastle, but the fire's just the same, you know, there's no difference. And so, and insurance and mortgage level and that is all really kind of done from a UK level. So I think it's got the potential to confuse the market and confuse the people living within buildings. And the PASS process allows that, you to take in all the information for a building and therefore, you know, come at what's a more realistic risk. The actual PASS process is about 53 sort of really defined risks that you look at. So everyone has become familiar with the process. And I think it is the way forward. It may not be perfect, but it certainly... would be lead for a far better outcome.
That's really helpful. Thanks.
Yeah, thanks for that. I think I'm getting confused because we talked earlier about the scope of the bill, and now we're talking about PAS and that's what we would want to do, and so PAS is just looking at fire safety, or so earlier on we were talking about we need to look at cladding to move that forward. And now we're talking about PAS. Would that look at more than, that's looking at the whole of fire safety, isn't it? So do we want something where we're using PAS to look at the whole building, but we're going to do the triage approach that Phil had suggested, where we get on with the cladding part of it, but we understand there's other pieces that we might need to come back and do. Is that, am I getting it right here? Or maybe you can explain a bit more. Yeah, okay, Gary.
So the PAS is about a methodology for assessing the external walls. So what's called an FRAEW, Fire Risk Assessment of the External Walls, that's the framework of the PAS. However, the FRAEW informs the holistic fire risk of the whole building. So in England, we have a fire risk assessment. You don't have that in Scotland as such, but it does inform that risk of the whole building. So just to clarify, it's about the FREW, is about the external walls.
Okay, that's really helpful. Thank you. I'm glad I asked that, because I'm sure I'm not the only one that was getting a bit lost there. Okay, Stephanie, are you... yes, thanks very much. Marie, if you'd like to come in.
Thank you, convener. Jim, I'm going to go to yourself first and then I'll open up. Do you feel there's enough qualified fire engineers, surveyors and building industry professionals in Scotland to undertake the single building assessment and the remediation work required within the timescale? If not, how might any kind of shortfall be tackled?
It was interesting actually hearing Phil mention earlier that you know, round about the 11 metre mark and up, it brings the numbers of buildings within the scope up to about 7,000, which is a huge number. And so I would certainly see that there's I think there would be a limited number of fire engineers currently in Scotland with appropriate knowledge and experience and training, you know, to do the external walls. And also that's also compounded with the fact that fire engineers and such don't want to take forward this work for a number of reasons, including, you know, the ongoing insurance costs. The other thing that also going forward, that I think you're saying, so how would we address that, and can we get other people in and, you know, trained to be fire engineers and such? And at the moment, I think that's going to be problematic because the Caledonia University, which does a fire engineering degree, you know, that the fire service, building standards, fire engineers and such, we all have gone through. This is the last year of it. That course is closing. So there's where other fire engineers are going to come from to help deal with this huge amount of buildings, I'm not really sure. So, yes, I would say there is a definite problem for having sufficient numbers of fire engineers in Scotland at the moment.
Thanks very much for that, Jim. Jocelyn.
Sorry, if I could just echo that point. I think one of the challenges or one of the things that is yet to be established is exactly who it is that will be able to undertake single building assessments. I'm conscious that the Cabinet Secretary and Scottish Government officials have used different language. Sometimes it's surveyors and fire engineers. Sometimes it's just competent fire engineers. The bill itself just says that ministers have the right to appoint people to undertake SBAs, and that might include a group of people with a particular qualification. I think one of the challenges that we've had in terms of the consultation with the cladding stakeholder working group to date is that their task and finish group has been somewhat closed doors in terms of that's just being developers and officials, or, you know, broadly speaking, it's developers and officials, and thus far professional bodies have not been part of those conversations. So I think that this is the challenge, is it we have skill shortages across the sector. It stands to reason we will probably not have enough people, especially given the scope of the buildings that, like Phil said, we might be facing a huge number of buildings that need these SBAs. So we don't really know who it's going to be in the first instance. We've not been around the table to sort of develop out the scope and the spec and to see who that might be. And then it's really difficult for professional bodies like the CIOB, and, you know, not to speak for Gary, but we would love to try to start communicating to our members and start making sure that we're moving in the direction we need to be to start training competent people, but we're not around the table to start doing that yet. So the earlier we can be part of these discussions, the better ready the industry can be, not only in terms of who's undertaking single building assessments, but also sort of educating and communicating to the wider industry what the impacts of this legislation are going to be so that they're ready to respond to it as well.
Okay, great. Kate.
Yes, good question. And we discussed this a bit earlier. I totally agree. There's going to be a lot of different people involved in that process. Whether there are enough competent people to do that. So for me, doing a pass assessment, for example, it's a fire safety assessment. You want someone to be a competent fire safety professional. If you take that to be a chartered fire engineer, so not just chartered, but a chartered fire engineer with sufficient experience. So as a chartered fire engineer, I would not undertake work that I don't have the experience to do. So you've got to be chartered. You've got to have the competence. You've got to have the willing. So not everybody wants to do external wall work, and the fire safety industry is very busy. And you've got to be available. So sort of our look ahead, you know, we might be available in 2 weeks. It might be 12 weeks, sort of depending on what our current workload is. Mm. I'm sure that's sort of similar for others who work in my industry. So I think it's quite limited. It is an issue. It's an issue we see in England at the moment as well for undertaking the same kind of work in terms of how to address it. I'm not really sure what I've got nothing more to add to what Jim said.
Thanks, Philip.
I think from that point of view, I maybe see it slightly differently. We know how many buildings there are. Not every one of those buildings needs a chartered fire engineer or a chartered building surveyor or a chartered architect or whatever. To me, the piece that's missing here is some kind of initial assessment, a fairly high level minor report, cladding census type scenario, find out what we're actually dealing with, then it can be streamed into, right, that one's very complex, that's chartered fire engineer territory, That one's, you know, not so complex. That can be, you know, two or three different disciplines and all the way down. And I think the phrase I used earlier on was building a competent army. There's no reason why this should be the preserve of chartered fire engineers and chartered building surveyors only. There should be chartered fire engineers, chartered building surveyors, chartered architects, chartered engineers. Anybody who builds stuff understands what's on these buildings. And as long as we're giving those people the right type of building to look at and they're properly trained, they have the competence and, critically, they have the professional indemnity insurance, there's no reason why we couldn't expand the skill set away from a purely needing chartered fire engineers.
Just if I can add to that, I do definitely agree that there's a lot of people to be involved in that process, and you don't necessarily need a chartered fire engineer in every circumstance. I do think it's important, though, that sort of, if you look at an initial triaging type of approach, like, you've got to make sure that the people making those decisions are competent enough to spot everything. So it might be a simple building, but you need somebody with sufficient experience to identify that initially.
I see that first part as a data capture exercise, not a survey as such, because that's the bit that's missing, to my mind.
Can you say a little bit more in your mind about the difference between a data capture and a survey?
Basically, you're trying to you know, where is the building? What is it? Is it clearly above 11 metres? You know, are there a mix of materials on the buildings? You know, you don't have to send somebody to say there are four materials on this building and they are the following. Think. I think the fact that it's not a uniform construction, you know, would alert you. I think you could design a survey programme that captured the data. Mm. It still has to be validated and, you know, checked and corrected, and moves on to then a more detailed survey process. But we're doing this from a standing start in Scotland. We don't have that data to hand. That's the first bit of the task to me.
Sorry, Phil, one last thing to add to that. I was involved a couple of years ago in this sort of single building assessment pilot. I actually went on maternity leave before it properly got started, but we did tried to help with that process a little bit as part of the IFE, and we found it quite difficult to, just the level of information you have, but we found it quite difficult to come up with an easy process to triage. So absolutely there'll be some buildings you can look at and say, you know, that the extreme case, you know, it's covered in Cat 3 ACM, obviously that's bad, or it's masonry, obviously that's fine. But looking at lots of different buildings and putting them in order, we found quite a challenging process. It did happen, there was lots of people involved, but I think in principle it's a good idea. It's just
okay, something to be maybe taken offline and discussed a bit further. But also it sounds like you have kind of a bit of proof of putting, you've kind of gone through some of that difficult bit, that maybe that's helpful. Marie, I'm going to go back to you with your next question.
Just a few
other
ones
want
to come back in.
Jocelyn and
Gary. I was just going to sort of reiterate, I think it's absolutely imperative that we build out exactly who it is that's competent and qualified to do these things, not only so that we know that the data that we're getting on these single building assessments is ironclad, and forgive the wording, and we know we've captured things accurately, but also we've got the public's trust to sort of regain here a little bit. And I think it's really important that we make sure that the people that we're going and are doing these things, we can demonstrate that they are competent and qualified. I would also just draw attention to the competence steering groups just published a report in the English context from the Construction Industry Council that sets out a bunch of competency frameworks. Again, I'm not necessarily endorsing any of those, but just to say there might be learnings from other jurisdictions that we can bring back to Scotland, and that report might be worth a review.
Okay, thanks. Gary.
Thanks. I was just going to share the experience we had with the training programme for EWS External Wall System Assessors. So DLUC grant funded us to put together a training programme because we recognised there was a shortage of chartered fire engineers, actually, because of the scale of the problem in England, the thousands of buildings that are in scope. And so DLUC approached us to see whether chartered building surveyors like Phil and myself could be trained to the level to do these external wall systems. And it's about competence. We want to make sure that we have the right base knowledge of experience to begin with, and then the skills, knowledge, experience and behaviours, the definition of competence now, is absolutely right. So our training course is a level 6 Ofqual, so it's degree level training course deliberately so that only people like Phil and myself are eligible to go on the course, and they'll be trained up to do external wall system assessments up to 18 metres. And then above 18 metres, which becomes a more complex building, we normally would refer to a chartered fire engineer, such as Kate, where we might be doing the survey work, but then the overall assessment is done by a chartered fire engineer because it's a more complex building. And that was to aim deliberately to try and increase the number of professionals in the market. So far we've had something like 1,300 applicants to the course. A lot of those are going through. Currently, we've had just over 120 have now passed the course and are now out in the market doing these. But we launched the course in January 2021. So it's been a slow grind. And what we found is actually, so is the course is open to not only just RICS chartered members, but IFE members as well. And the RIBA, the architects, actually didn't really want to get involved. They found it actually quite a very challenging complex process in terms of external wall system assessments and the high risk if you get it wrong, obviously, and then obviously the challenges around professional indemnity insurance. So those challenges in the mix meant that we, our pipeline of people coming through has actually been quite slow, and was quite surprising in a way, because we thought we'd actually have, you know, several hundred by now that are qualified and available in the marketplace. And actually in Scotland we only have one, we only have one course completer. So that gives you the scale, I think, of the appetite for people to want to do this work in the first place and then actually complete the course. And it's a tough course, you know, the failure rate is quite high, but we make no apologies for that, because we want people to go through and really understand what they're doing and pass the assessments, etc., and then graduate on the course and be able to do these and have, you know, restore the confidence in the public that they know what they're doing. I think there's plenty of work for people. You don't necessarily have to go through the course. It's not a mandatory course. There's plenty of people like Phil, for example, that are out there doing this work and have got the competence to do it. But I would just say that we have to be really careful that we have the right people doing it, and we don't just let anybody go in thinking they're suddenly an expert in external wall systems, when we found our experience is that, you know, often they don't know what they're talking about. So we have to be really, really careful about that.
Okay. Thanks for that. Very brief supplementary from Stephanie Callahan, then we're going to come back to Marie with her second question.
Yeah, just on that point that you were talking about there, Gary, as well, then you're saying, you know, they have to be competent. So how would you go about defining that, you know, if they've not got that qualification, for example? And are you talking about, you know, you've not had that many people applying, if it was something we were looking at, would that be better targeted at the type of people who have been most interested
in
it?
So the course eligibility requirements that are set by DLUC is that you have to be a member of a professional body, and then it's defined as you have to be a chartered member of a professional body. So if you're an RICS, you have to be a chartered surveyor, and not a lower grade, and the same with IFE as well. So you have to be at that kind of chartered level to go onto the course to then undertake the training. So that's the initial base knowledge we're expecting people to have before they're eligible. So, for example, we wouldn't let somebody who is like an interior designer, for example, be eligible for the course because they've got no background in fire safety that we can determine, no official training, professional qualifications around any of that at all. And frankly, they'd be wasting their own time as well as ours by undertaking the course. They'd fail the assessment with, absolutely. So.
Okay, thanks.
Have that qualification, so it was a question around as well, how do you find then who would have those skills, so maybe that could get rolled in as we go on. Thanks.
Thank you, Stephanie. Marie, back to you.
I can follow it up if you want more information about the training. And
yeah, that would be helpful. Yeah. Thank you.
I'm going to go back to Gary for my next question. Gary, listen to your previous comments and given your experience, what is your understanding of how the single building assessment process will work with the EWS1 process, and there's any way to streamline the operation of the two systems?
Well, the EWS1 process came about in 2019 because of the complete snarling up of the lending market, and lenders, you know, not willing to lend on tower blocks that it may have or may not have some form of combustible cladding. So we had to find a process with the support of DLUC to find our way through that. But we always envisaged it would be a temporary process because there was nothing else out there that existed at all. So the EWS1 process came about as a way to try and find a way through assessing blocks fairly quickly as to whether they were safe or not safe. And so although the EWS1 form has got a five-year time span, and we'll be coming up to the fifth-year anniversary at the end of this year, we do see that fading away, the EWS1 process. So, and that is up on our FAQs on our website, we make that point quite strongly that this is a temporary process. So if the SBA process is robust enough and it gives you the information you require and it can be relied upon as a standard, sufficiently robust standard, then fine. What we need is transparency so that valuers, lenders, insurers, etc., can all rely on that that process. It does have to be robust, because otherwise the default may be still that people would still go back to EWS1, which we just don't see as being a long-term thing. I know that my colleague John Maher from UK Finance, who was one of our partners along with the Building Societies Association for developing the EWS1, is next to appear on the panel. You might want to ask him that question, but as far as we are concerned jointly, we're happy to work with Scottish Government officials around that EWS1 process and how the SBA would eventually replace it.
Sure.
The EWS1 form, in the back of it, has a pile of small print, and part of that small print says that it has to be preceded by a PAS 990 assessment. So I'm maybe reading too much between the lines here, but if there's a notion that the EWS1 in Scotland is somehow going to be tied to the SBA process in Scotland, that would be a disaster for the Scottish property portfolio, because all of a sudden there will be no buildings in Scotland that can physically pass EWS1.
Sure.
Yeah, I think it's an important point. We made changes to the EWS1 form to when PAS 980 was launched, actually. So we're on version 3 of the form now, and it heavily references PAS 980. So that would be a real concern for us. Good point, Phil.
Thanks for that.
Okay. Thanks very much. And now I'm going to bring in Miles Briggs with our final question.
Thank you, Convener. Morning, everyone. Thanks for your input so far. I wanted to ask a couple of questions. Firstly, in relation to local authorities and their building standard departments, and whether or not you believe they're suitably resourced and to deal with what will be an increased amount of work associated with cladding remedial works, including new requirements imposed on developers, and those specifically who are not part of the responsible developer scheme.
Maybe we'll go with Alan online.
See, yep.
First.
Thank you. Yeah, I think local authority verifiers, we do recognise that the building warrant approval process is the last stage before warrantable cladding remediation work can commence on site, and appreciate the need for an efficient assessment process. I think overall, Labs, we are comfortable that local authorities will be able to manage the building warrant application processes that come from cladding remediation sufficiently. I think if we are looking at lowering the trigger height below 11 metres, with the number of buildings that brings in, then that maybe needs another discussion. But I think looking at the kind of spending information from the cladding remediation team to date, there are a relatively small number of authorities affected, these being the larger city authorities, generally used to dealing with complex and sensitive applications, as do many other authorities as well. But I think just that reassurance of an effective building warrant assessment process does rely on a whole range of cooperation with other stakeholders. We would want to be involved in the pre-application discussion stage so that verifiers are set up and are aware of the building warrant applications that may be coming down the line in terms of the assessment. We would also want to make sure that warrant applications are competent and complete to allow that full assessment to be undertaken. And again, we would want any design team to respond to any issues that we raise as part of our warrant assessment. We have already engaged with colleagues in Glasgow City Council to understand the process that they went through on remediation projects to date, and we'll use that learnings to work with verifiers on any applications that are on the horizon. And I think in general terms, Labs and my own role within the Building Standards Hub will support verifiers, and if we have to work collaboratively between them, we will do to make sure that we progress these warrant applications as quickly as possible. We are looking at different considerations in terms of the competence to undertake an SBA and indeed the PAS risk assessment, and the competence to assess any building warrant application against the requirements of the technical handbooks. That's what we do day in, day out, and we have extensive experience in that regard. If there are areas of complexity within that that require oversight and cooperation from expertise within any one authority, we can call on that and work collaboratively to do that. And again, we need to work in partnership with this regard, so I hope that that Labs and the Hub will be able to work with the Scottish Government's cladding remediation team, so that we are aware of the programme that's on the horizon. And again, the final point that I would want to make is that we need to allow time for the building warrant, you know, and it is at the end of the process, but if we allow for that, a reasonable time for it, then I don't see any issues with Labs and the Verify community addressing those building warrants when required to do so.
Thanks. Kate?
At the time, so I'll try and be quick. Just a reflection back on the competency point from earlier, really. Some of our experience south of the border is that when undertaking sort of works to apply for a building safety fund, for example, there hasn't necessarily always been checks and balances in place to check that what you're applying for is actually what's necessary to make the building safe. So, for example, if you have a building with combustible cladding, it's not necessarily that you need to take everything combustible off that wall and replace it with completely non-combustible components. So just would like to make the point that it's important that there's competency through the process. It's the single building assessment, PASS 9 and 80, is going to be new for both professionals in Scotland working as consultants, but for local authorities as well. So I'd say it's really key to make sure that we've got competent mm-hmm. people on both sides of that assessing, you know, what work needs to be done.
Yep.
We don't want to spend too much or too little.
Okay. That's Thanks helpful. For that.
And just finally, I wanted to ask if there's anything specific you think should be in the bill, which isn't. We've had quite a wide conversation around the scope of the bill. Specific concerns have been raised with us with regards to electric batteries in cars and bikes in buildings with underground parking. Which currently isn't within the scope of this bill, but the recommendations we can put to ministers in our report, I think, should capture some of that. So just wondered if there's anything specific you thought we should also include in that.
I think I made this point to you previously, but legal title is a problem in a lot of these landmark developments where you have, for example, a small garden area
yep.
that's actually assigned to a flat. So you need to think ahead about that type of situation, because you don't probably have the right legally to go in and erect a scaffolding on somebody's garden to put up a to do a cladding remediation scheme. So I didn't see a mechanism for
scaffolding
for that. Yeah. So that'll be a blocker downstream.
Yep.
Anybody with anything else that might have been overlooked?
Jocelyn, say I think the way that we've sort of looked at this is sort of start small and develop it. I know issues have been raised previously, and my colleagues in the CIOB in the English context have raised concerns about non-residential buildings. I think what we're looking at again is this is as a first step, and that there's going to be a natural evolution and progress to this bill. So I think there are probably other things, as we've raised elsewhere, that will come up down the line, and we see this as sort of a start small, move on from there. Let's get on with what we need to get on with, and also consider some of the things that we might need to start looking to address over time.
At UK level, or in England anyway, they have included hotels and care homes. The bill doesn't currently include those. Do you think they should be?
The problem in Scotland, in a Scottish context, isn't only a developer problem. There's issues with developers, contractors, housing associations, even ScotGov themselves are, you know, until as far as I'm aware, very recently, still applying combustible cladding to the outside of buildings via heap schemes and eco schemes and things like that. So it worries me that it is quite narrowly focused on that individual part, because we know fine that the problem's way beyond just the developers.
Mm-hmm.
We've argued in the English context as well for inclusion of buildings, like you've mentioned, and I think I'm conscious that I think it's section 26 of the bill as it is sort of limits the extension of the SBA to buildings that don't have or are not intended to have dwellings. So I think it's something that we've advocated for elsewhere and needs to be looked at, to your point, Phil.
I think it's defined as the sleeping risk. So yes, you know, the highest risk is the sleeping risk. So you've got people sleeping in a building for whatever reason, then that's why, which including hospitals, for example, you know, so there's a high risk there, which is why that's defined in England. So, I mean, it's something certainly to look at. The other thing I was going to raise was about mixed-use buildings, because mixed-use buildings are the ones that cause us quite a lot of concern, where you may have a shopping centre or whatever with residential flats above it, and then that starts to cause issues around risk as well. So, so when you did, coming back to the definitions of what's in the bill, are you meaning mixed use because there's a residential sitting above something else? You know, so that's the type of thing I think where it would certainly would help to try and clarify that.
Thanks, Camina.
Okay, thank you very much. I think that was helpful to get that perspective as well. So thank you so much. I think it's been a really productive, constructive conversation, and there's quite a lot of insight from all of your expertise in various areas. I'm now going to briefly suspend the meeting to allow for a change of witnesses. Our second panel today, we are joined in the room by John Marr, who's the Principal of Devolved Government and Social Housing from UK Finance, and John Sinclair, who's the Convener of the Property Law Committee at the Law Society of Scotland. And we are also joined online by Callum McQueen, who's a Technical Surveying Manager at ESERV Chartered Surveyors, and we are hoping that we will be joined by Mervyn Skeet, who is the Director of General Insurance Policy at the Association of British Insurers, and we're doing everything that we can to make sure that Mervyn will be able to join us. And I welcome our witnesses to the meeting. We're going to turn to questions from members, and I'd ask that you indicate it to me if you'd like to come in to respond to a member's question. And Callum, if you can type an R in the chat function, then we know that you want to come in on a question. There's no need for you to manually turn on your microphones, as we'll do that for you automatically. One less thing to have to think about. I'm going to start with a couple of broader questions before we get into some of the detail of aspects of the bill. The first one is around consultation and engagement in terms of your organisation. So the Scottish Government didn't publicly consult on the proposals for the bill, but I'd be interested to hear if your organisations had any opportunity to input into its development, and if so, how effective was the engagement in terms of improving the bill we see before us? So maybe, John Marr, you could start.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning, everyone, and thanks for inviting me to your session this morning. So in terms of consultation on the bill itself, clearly it was introduced in quite sharp order with a limited opportunity to comment publicly in terms of providing views on its proposals. And we recognise that there is a need to move at pace in progressing cladding remediation north of the border. So in many respects, it can be said to be right that the legislation is proceeding through the accelerated route. Notwithstanding that, from our perspective at UK Finance, I can say that we have had quite considerable involvement and engagement with officials over a number of years on cladding and building safety issues. And UK Finance was around the table at the earlier ministerial working group, which provided its report, I think, in 2020. And we've continued to be at the table since then as the programme has evolved through into the what's now the cladding stakeholder group. So there has been involvement. It's been welcomed. Involvement with officials is always welcome in terms of informing development of issues such as these. But as far as the bill itself is concerned, yes, it has been rather a short period of consultation, which would have been beneficial if it had been longer, but we recognise the challenges in bringing it forward quickly.
Okay, thanks very much for that. Just before we move on, I'm going to welcome Mervyn. Good to see you, Mervyn. Just to let you know, I've opened with a question which is around consultation on the bill. Was your organisation, did your organisation have the opportunity to engage in it? And if so, has the engagement been effective in improving the bill we see before? So a few questions around engagement there. But I won't put you on the spot and go to you next. Maybe John Sinclair, would you like to come in?
Thank you. I would actually almost entirely reflect John Marr's comments. I'll keep it brief.
Okay.
Basically, we welcome being part of the ministerial working group. We've been involved in that. Our engagement on the bill, the cladding assurance register, has been, I understand, primarily limited to the response to consultation.
Okay, great. Thanks very much. Callum, what about the technical, what about the e-survey charter surveyors?
We weren't consulted, no, prior to the bill coming out, but we have made comments on the bill through the consultation process.
Okay, thanks very much. And Mervyn, has the Association of British Insurers been engaged?
Yes, hopefully you can hear me now.
Yes, absolutely.
Some good stuff. Yes, we have been engaged. My colleague Alastair Ross has been representing the ABI on the cladding stakeholder group. So, yes, and we've responded to the consultation.
Okay, so great. And do you feel that your engagement has help to improve the bill in the process?
Yes, I mean, it's been good engagement. I think there's still some work to be done, and I'm sure we'll get to that as we move through the questions.
Okay, great. Thanks very much. My next question is actually about the scope of the bill. So it's the cladding remediation bill. Do you think that it should remain solely a bill that focuses on cladding remediation, or should it extend to cover all fire safety issues or even all significant building safety matters? Maybe I will start with Callum McQueen. What do you think of the scope?
So I'm primarily involved with cladding issues, so that is really important. I don't really see, it's not really my decision to decide what the scope of the bill should be. That would perhaps complicate matters. I mean, it has been quite slow so far, the Scottish response to the cladding issue, so perhaps a more focused response would be better rather than widening out.
Okay, thanks very much. And Mervyn, what do you think?
We think it should be wider than just cladding. I mean, we should be focused on all fire safety issues. That's what's driving insurance premiums. So we think it should be beyond just pure cladding and look at all fire safety issues.
Okay. And that's because you said because the wider safety issues is what's is affecting the premiums.
Yes, insurance is looking at the whole building and the potential loss of the whole building, and if there are other fire safety issues within the building which aren't just cladding, that will also impact how insurers will look at the building in terms of the loss of the building or loss of part of the building if it was damaged.
Okay, and what are your thoughts about in the previous session and other panels? There's a kind of concern around this, the urgency. It's partly why the government hasn't taken the time to consult, because there's an urgency to move forward with it. So how do you balance that urgency to move forward with remediating the cladding, but then also broadening the scope from an insurance perspective? I'd be interested to hear what your thoughts are on that.
I mean, so obviously cladding is an important part of the concerns here and the issues here. We shouldn't prevent cladding being removed, waiting for other stuff to be done. But at the same time, if we want to see insurance premiums be reduced, then we need to focus on all fire safety issues to ensure the building is safe from that perspective.
Okay, thanks very much. And anybody in the room want to comment on the scope? John Marr.
Thank you. I mean, clearly cladding issues are perhaps the most visible manifestation in residential blocks of the wider sort of malaise around building safety. So, you know, in that sort of single respect, it can be argued that the focus is rightly on cladding. However, as Mervyn's just mentioned, and indeed witnesses at your earlier session this morning mentioned, there can be quite significant and costly building safety defects deeper into a building. So specifically things about compartmentation and other issues, you know, defective doors to apartments and the likes. And I think it can be very difficult to part fix a building. Quite often, as fire engineers and others will comment, when you start to strip away the cladding, it's then that you realise that there are significant and quite high-risk issues elsewhere. And it would be, to an extent, perhaps irresponsible not to address those issues when they have become visible. So it is a challenge. Clearly, resources are limited, and the process has to start somewhere. So in that respect, you know, I can understand why it's cladding remediation. However, that doesn't mean to say that all of the other issues which can affect life risk should be avoided or dealt with later down the line.
All right. Thanks very much. John Sinclair.
Okay. We, as a committee, we had no specific view on this point, but we had comments in relation to the Act as a whole, in relation to its integration with the wider legal framework. And I think that if the scope of the bill is to be expanded to include non-cladding fire safety issues, then I think it will exacerbate the consequences of this bill being dropped into a sort of a wider legal framework without also reflecting on the changes that maybe should be made in relation to prescription, in relation to further allocation of liability between any parties who had an involvement in the construction of the building, but also will then operate differently in the context of subsequent alterations, maintenance to the building. So we have no specific view on that point, but we would comment on some of the complexities that may flow from it.
Mm. Thanks very much. So the complexities of a bill, so the bill is narrowly focused because it's trying to navigate a legal context that it's going to sit within. And what you're saying is that if we widen it, then there's going to be many other aspects that would need to be considered, which then could maybe start to take more time in terms of the need to actually get on with the job.
Yes. And so and another way of putting it is that the cladding remediation is enforced, is driven by the responsible developer scheme, which is imposing a liability on the developer entities. One of the concerns is that is that a voluntary assumption of risk, in which case, if there are other parties who should bear responsibility for or liability for the work that was carried out, how does that risk then properly flow or liability properly flow through, taking into consideration things like prescription and the fact that they may be deemed to voluntarily assumed a risk? These are ancillary issues, but if the bill is to be expanded, it would be good for them to be considered at the same time.
Okay, great. I think that's very helpful, given that we're making some legislation here. Okay, I'm now going to bring in Mark Griffin, my colleague Mark Griffin, who's joining us online today.
Thank you, Kumira. Good morning. We've heard previously from witnesses' concerns that certain key terms within the bill aren't as clearly defined as they could be. People have talked about the meaning of development, premises and risk to human life. Well, we had contrasted evidence at the previous session. Just wonder if any witnesses have got any concerns about the terms that have been used in the bill, whether they need further clarity or more in the face of the bill on those definitions.
Maybe we'll start with John Sinclair. You knew I was going to come to you first.
short answer is yes, we do have concerns. To pick maybe three or four or four or five, the term development is used. It is defined for the purposes of Section 25. But Section 24, which is to do with the Responsible Developer Scheme, to do with the SBA definition, it refers to constructed or otherwise undergone development. I fully appreciate the need to have a wide net and a wording that has the flexibility to cope with a wide range of circumstances. But it does leave open considerable questions. So, for example, if you have a mixed-use building, for example, built in 1980, you'd start off saying that falls out with the scope of a single building assessment being pre-1992. However, if that shop had a planning permission granted for alterations to a shop front that constituted development in, say, 2000, would that bring an otherwise 1980 building into the scope of an SBA? And if it did, how, if someone is looking at that particular building in 2026, how easy would it be for someone to assess whether or not that building in fact fell within the ambit of an SBA?
Okay. I can see like the thorniness of all of that immediately, and that's just with one word.
Yes, and I apologise. As lawyers, we will come up with all the negatives, despite the fact that this is an important bill and it's doing something that needs to be done.
Yeah, and I think no apology is needed. It's really about we need to get this right and we need to have that clarity of understanding so everybody is moving in the right direction together.
We had also thought that the meaning of risk to human life was another area that would benefit from being more fully defined. Section 25 also refers to the mediation standards to be set by the Scottish ministers. That also is a sort of an open-ended and uncertain concept, and whether it's to be limited purely to risk to human life, or if there will be other considerations that the Scottish ministers may take into account. I think the previous session had mentioned difficulties with premises, and yes, we can see, particularly in a situation where you have a block of flats within a wider scheme where there is a relatively complicated matrix of individual ownership of gardens, ownership amongst the block of adjacent parking, or wider ownership amongst the proprietors of the entire development for other areas. And so I think some clarity about that would be welcomed.
Okay.
Possibly the final thing to mention, but I suspect it may come up later on, is that there is a reference to the single building assessment, and then the single building assessment report, and then works identified in the single building assessment report. When we were looking at how this might actually operate in practice, and particularly in relation to the timing of appeals, we are unclear as to just how much detail of the works would require to be contained within the single building assessment report. To explain, in terms of our understanding would be that the single building assessment would identify that works are required. There'd then be a set of decisions about what those works would be. And between that point and carrying out any works, you then have the generation of a very, very detailed set of specifications and a reference to the building warrant. And we cannot see the clarity in the Act in terms of what is a level of detail that is required for the works when there are references to the works being identified in.
Okay, that's clearly quite an important piece to tease out more. Is there anything else? I think this is quite useful.
I'll stop there and hand over to others.
Okay, thanks. Anybody else got any comments on the key terms in the bill? John Marr.
Thanks very much. So it's excellent to have a legal view on all of these issues. And in fact, I think what John was describing there really highlights perhaps the need for a lot of these definitions to be worked on in great detail and reflected perhaps not on the face of the bill, but elsewhere in secondary legislation as might be required. In the earlier session this morning, I mean, some of the fire professionals commented that there are, I think, four different definitions of height, which, you know, just on one measure alone indicates how challenging it is to arrive at a particular definition for the purposes of this bill. But other than that, I think there are definitely priority areas where it would be useful to have early clarity in terms of what we're actually talking about. And certainly the SBA itself, right at the top of the agenda, I think there is a critical need for clarity around what that is and around the remediation standards as well, because these issues really factor in quite significantly into where we all go from here and certainly where developers go in terms of preparing themselves to fix buildings that they're responsible for. I think the other point that was an interesting one, which was reflected earlier, was around interpretation of terms and where perhaps there are loosely or broadly framed, then there is increasing scope for legal and other arguments about what they actually mean. So defining them closely will be a priority task, but whether or not they need to be defined on the face of the bill is, I think, another issue.
Thanks very much. Callum, you wanted to come in.
Yep, thanks. Just a couple of comments. I would agree with John on the definition of height. I don't think you're ever going to come to a single definition of the height of a building. There are differences north and south of the border in building regulations on that, so that's going to be a constant issue. The other comment I'd like to make is where the bar is set for remediation. My understanding is that the Scottish Government wants to remediate these buildings to the current building regulations standard, whereas south of the border, the decision is the building safe or not. It's usually left up to the fire engineer or building surveyor to make that decision as to whether a building is safe. So that is an issue. There has been some concern with lenders where they have felt that a building may be considered safe, and then if a single building assessment is carried out, additional work may be required because the standard is higher than was previously assessed.
Okay, great, perfect. Okay, thanks. That's interesting. Yeah, and I think the floor height definition we learned in the previous panel was in England. I don't know what the situation is in Scotland, but clearly there's different things, as Callum has said, different north and south of the border. I'm going to bring in Pam Gosol with a couple of questions.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. Last week, witnesses expressed the need to rapidly get to a place where everyone agrees, banks and insurers included. On the cladding assurance register, we have heard concerns that because of all the work in the building needs to be completed before, they can be included on the register. Then there is a risk that more substantial cladding remediation works may have been completed, but the building is still not declared safe if other works remain outstanding. Would completion of the substantial remediation works be enough for the insurers to be comfortable insuring it? Could I ask the question to Mervyn first? Is that...
Sorry, can you repeat the last bit of the question? I'm sorry, I heard most of it, but not the last bit.
All right. Would completion of the substantial remediation works be enough for insurers to be comfortable insuring it?
So insurers are insuring buildings now, but there is a difference between life safety and building resilience and from an insurance perspective. So obviously life safety is very, very important, and it's important that people can get out of the building. And that's pretty much the standard that's in PAS 9980. But in order for premiums to come down substantially, then we're looking for an enhanced PAS 9980 where the resilience of the building is considered as well. So, because we're looking at what the potential loss would be to the insurance company of insuring that building should there be a fire or other peril. And that maximum loss has gone up significantly if the whole building is at risk and rather than, you know, individual units within the building. So in terms of insuring, the insurers are insuring those buildings now, but in terms of getting the prices down for the cost of insurance, then we're focused on enhanced standards to a building resilience standard.
Thank you. Is there anybody else?
John.
So just on that, I mean, taking it back to the cladding assurance register, we've been very clear that we would like to see buildings entered on the register at an earlier point in the remediation process rather than at the conclusion, because we feel that having that upfront transparency and visibility that a building has been assessed, that works are being programmed, that they will be carried out and paid for, will help the market transact those properties sooner rather than later. If we go through a three-year, two-year, however long it takes, remediation process on a building, and wait for all of that time before then saying to the market, yes, it's fine, it's been fixed, then the residents in that building will probably have been struggling to buy, sell, remortgage their homes throughout that whole time. So I think early entry in the register would be a benefit to the market. It would provide transparency and visibility, as I say, and help to give that assurance that things will be done, that the work won't be completed straight away, but it's programmed, we know how it's going to be paid for, and that will help to free things up.
Okay, thanks. Callum, you wanted to come in.
Just to echo John's comments, that yes, a building should be put on the register when it has been identified as one that will be fixed. Lenders will consider that information and certainly consider lending on the building. If you do wait until the building is fixed, then that's going back to the situation in England prior to the Building Safety Act, when buildings that were identified as needing work would not be lent upon until the work was completed and signed off. Whereas now, lenders do lend on buildings that require work once it's been identified who is going to pay for those works. So that is an opportunity to open up the market for these properties in Scotland.
Okay, thanks. John Marr, you want to come back in, and then I don't know, Jonathan Clare, if you want to come in too.
Just a further point on that. I mean, I think this is all about evidence. And it's about evidence that costed and funded remediation plans are in place and that a building will be fixed. And with that evidence, in the form of an early entry on the register, that will enable, and we have RICS in the gallery, and they were here in the earlier session, RICS will then be able to update their cladding valuation framework. Because there's evidence that valuers will be able to take into account to help inform their valuation decisions, which in turn will inform a lender's decision to lend.
Okay, thanks. Jonathan Clare.
Thank you. The Lost Studies position is the same, that if there is information available, or if there is information generated, it should be available on the register. But buying a flat is going to be the single biggest financial commitment that many people make in their lives, and to be able to make that decision on a fully informed basis we think is very important. And so if there is information that is has been generated, then it should be on the register, we think.
Okay.
We would also, just for ease of operation of the market, we would like to see, if possible, a register of buildings that have been assessed and have been assessed as falling out with the scope of an SBA. Otherwise, every time you look at a building that's potentially within scope, every single purchase will need to go through the same process. If that's the reference to uncertainty as to with the meaning of height, for example, it would be beneficial for the market if buildings could be declared either or declared non-SBA relevant.
Okay. Can you say a bit more about that?
Yes, it's just basically if every time a flat is sold in a building, someone comes along and applies the same criteria, then theoretically they should get the same result each time. But if there is dubiety or there's a qualitative element about the measurement of height, which there shouldn't be, or about whether it's it would be better for that decision to be made once and recorded, okay, so that it's then not a process that needs to be gone through on every single sale of a flat within that building.
Okay, great. Thanks very much. Mervyn, you wanted to come in.
Yeah, sure. Just to complete the set, would it support also everything being put on the register as soon as possible? That would allow insurers to look at the remediation that's being carried out and take into account the work that's been done up front, so the more transparency we can have around access to the work, to the scope of the work and what's on the register, would be for the better in terms of insurance premiums.
Okay, great. Thanks very much for that.
Got one more question. Thank you. A previous witness in their written submission raised concerns about the appropriate balance of responsibility for funding remediation work. And I note that in writing, the Law Society of Scotland expressed concerns that the bill will place commercial pressure on developers to fund remedial works without building a coherent legal framework for distributing costs between all relevant parties. Could you expand a little on that and what sort of implications it would have for developers and the remediation programme more broadly to proceed without coherent legal framework? Can I ask John St. Clare that question?
Yes. So if there was a failure in construction or a failure in design that resulted in the cladding being inadequate at the time at which it was installed, then the chances are that the developer would have a remedy against either the contractor or the consultant who constructed the building or the consultant who specified the materials or monitored, supervised it. The concern is that the remedies and rights that the developer would have had this come to light earlier will probably have expired or be unenforceable due to, for example, prescription. And so you are addressing one very particular focused route of liability, and in some ways potentially creating a new liability or new obligations, but without addressing the downstream liabilities that might otherwise have existed. So that would be one example. Happy to come back in a fuller written version of this, because there are details that would be are somewhat beyond me, but which I think would be good for us to express. They sort of veers more into litigation territory than property law territory.
Okay, that would be very welcome. Thank you. I am now going to bring in Marie McNair.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. Mervyn, we understand that in England, mortgage lenders have established a portal of properties with completed EWS1 forms, and this tool has led to more efficient process. Could you see a register operating in a similar manner here, or do you think that a similar portal would be beneficial in Scotland?
So is that a question for insurance? Sorry, I'm just double checking.
So obviously, it's talking about the England mortgage lenders have established a portal of properties. So just kind of say it was your question.
Okay. I mean, certainly the EWS form is designed for property valuation, and that doesn't really have a major effect on insurance. So I'm not sure the point of your question. I'm sorry. I'm not sure I'm understanding how insurance would play a role in that.
Okay, maybe we'll go to John Maher on that one.
So thanks very much. I think what you're referring to there is a portal which was set up by the FIA to host completed EWS1 forms, and a number of the larger mortgage lenders provided some funding to help set that up. But essentially, you know, this comes back, I think, to there being a publicly accessible place, repository, portal, website, register, whatever it's called, which can provide information to the market, to buyers, sellers, valuers, lenders, estate agents, anyone who's involved in the home buying and selling process, conveyancers, of course, to be able to check that a building has been completed in terms of its remediation work, or that works are programmed and will be paid for and completed in a reasonable time frame. So it's about having that online resource which anyone in the home buying and selling process can check.
Thank you. Do you think we would benefit from that in Scotland?
Well, I think, you know, I can see that the proposed cladding assurance register could effectively provide that sort of that sort of resource, and in that respect, the proposal is a positive one. Subject to what I was saying earlier, that it would be more beneficial to register a building sooner rather than later in the process.
Cheers. Apologies, Mervyn, for getting mixed up with.
No problem.
Regards to
no
you, I thought it was mortgage. Cheers.
No problem at all.
Okay, thanks. I'm just going to ask a bit more, and I'm going to come to John Maher and Mervyn on this, a little bit more about the cladding assurance register. And you may have touched on it, but I just want to kind of bottom it out a bit. So I'm interested to hear how confident you are that the mortgage lenders, in your case, John, will accept the building's entry on the cladding register as proof that a property is free from significant fire safety defects. And will borrowers and residents be able to access financial products at a general market rate?
Thank you. So there are a number of issues within that question, convener. I think one of them is really, again, it was touched on in the earlier session, is what is the purpose of the register? And when the information might be accessed. So if a building has just gone through an SBA assessment and is entered on the register, clearly, the work to remediate it will not have taken place and probably won't take place for some years into the future, 2-3 years or however long it takes. So looking at the register at that initial point, it wouldn't be possible to conclude that the building is safe because the work hasn't been done. However, looking at the register again, at the end of the remediation process, it would be possible to make a conclusion reasonably that the building is safe. In terms of mortgage lending and insurance decisions, and Mervyn will come in on that, this really comes back again to evidence, which is a point I mentioned earlier. And this also feeds into the valuation piece, because it's about providing reliable, coherent information to valuers, lenders, and insurers in a timely way, which will enable them to make their own professional judgment in terms of the risk that they might be looking at. So obviously an insurance risk from the perspective of Mervyn and his members, and from a mortgage lender's perspective, the risk would be about their prospective borrower being able to afford the mortgage, or there might be risks associated with a negative impact on the valuation of the property. So again, just sort of coming back, it's really about what the register is for, what it's intended to do, and I think it's about when people access the information on it. Because, as I say, if you look at the beginning of the process and at the end of the process, you'll get a different answer in terms of whether or not a building is safe.
All right, that's great. So the register is not a point in time. It's really kind of it has a kind of inherent process in it.
I think this issue, convener, touches on something else which the committee has been considering, which is about, is there something more beyond the end point of completion of remediation works? It's about looking at a building throughout its life, and cladding remediation might be one point or one period of time in that building's life, but it will continue beyond remediation. It will continue in terms of its use, maintenance, and future adaptation. So it might be useful, and it's certainly something which the committee's considered, to consider the register as a dynamic living thing rather than purely something which is static and defined only in terms of cladding remediation work.
Okay, great. Thanks for that. Mervyn, would you like to come in with the insurance perspective?
Sure. I mean, I would concur with much of what John said there, right, that the register should be, I mean, a living document would be very good to make sure that it keeps accurate and factual as to the state of the building at any given point in time. I do think it needs to be regularly updated, and I do think there is going to be a different assessment as to, depending on whether the building's been remediated or not. The other thing I think is worth mentioning is that we want to make sure that there's enough scrutiny and oversight by the regulator on the risk assessments that are done to make sure that they actually are done to the correct standard, and therefore the register reflects the right position of the building. So that, I think that's really important too. So most of what John said makes sense to us as well, that the register needs to be kept updated at all times, and it will depend as to where you are in the remediation cycle as to how the buildings are looked at on the register.
Okay, great. Thanks very much. I think there's more to that, but I'm going to move on to make sure that we get to some of the other questions we wanted to ask, and I'm going to bring in Willie Coffey.
Thanks very much, convener. I'm probably going to combine two questions I had into one to ask you to help me understand the issues relating to the single building assessment and what role the quality standard, the PAS 9980, has, and what role the EWS1 process has in that, to strengthen that. Now, in the previous panel, Gary's still sitting behind you there, who I think said if the single building assessment is robust enough, then we won't need an EWS1. The SPEA would replace that. But then Phil reminded us that the EWS1 has loads of small print and it has to be preceded by a PAS 9980. So if we lose the EWS1, we may lose the quality standard assurance framework given to us by PAS. Yeah, I hope I've articulated that accurately on behalf of Closio. I'm just curious, where do we stand in your view with single building assessment? We've heard John Sinclair saying it needs to be clarified in certain places, and we've heard John Marr saying perhaps that's for secondary legislation. But how can the quality standard and the EWS1 assist us to get the single building assessment correct in the shape that we need it to be, perhaps? Maybe I'm asking that. John Marr, maybe I could open with you, John.
Thank you very much. Well, it is all a bit of an alphabet soup with EWS and SBA and SAN, the Scottish Advice Note. But as Gary Strong mentioned in his evidence in the earlier session, EWS1 was developed in late 2019. We're now some years down the line from that. It has been updated a couple of times in its life, but it was always envisaged to be a temporary intervention, essentially as a valuation tool to enable valuers to provide a reliable, certain market value on properties which were affected by building safety issues. As discussions have proceeded around the SBA, I think we've always been clear in our discussions with officials that it would be appropriate for EWS1 to fall away in time when the SBA is fully up and running and scoped and defined. Now, obviously, in the interim, we've had the development of PAS 9980, which, as the committee has heard in the earlier session, is a highly regarded, thoroughly adopted methodology for undertaking fire risk assessments of external wall systems. And so on that basis, there is no reason why PAS shouldn't be reflected in the SBA process. It's already there, it's recognised, it's understood, it's embedding into the market, and practitioners are becoming familiar and skilled in using it. So for the SBA, there's something there already on the shelf. There isn't really a need to go back and reinvent the wheel. I think if the SBA was developed in a way which aligned with the PAS, then that would be a positive step forward. And then just to go back to your point about EWS, in one of its most recent iterations, the EWS was updated so that it also aligns with the PAS. So it can work with PAS. The SBA at the moment, I don't think is quite there yet, but there could be work done to enable it to align, and then we'd have that commonality of methodology and approach going forward.
Mm-hmm. So they're complementary rather than in conflict. These are not conflicting standards, they're all complementary and seeking the same outcome.
Certainly in terms of PAS and EWS, they have been aligned, or EWS has been adapted and aligned to reflect the PAS. There's still, I think, a journey to go in respect of the SBA.
Mm-hmm. Any other views on that issue of the alphabet soup that John Marr described there to add some clarity to our understanding, at least as a committee? John?
Okay, the law society, we can't comment on the technical standards, but what we would comment on is that there are currently purchasers buying flats on the strength of an EWS1. And there would be a significant dent to the confidence in the market and, to the market and the process of purchasing if, having bought on the strength of an EWS1, they were then faced with selling against an SBA that required works. And so there would be, I suppose, an expectation that the two would be aligned. Otherwise, and if not, then there would be consequences in terms of market confidence and the operation of the market.
Good. Any other questions?
I think both Callum and then Mervyn want to come in.
Thank you. A couple of points. The EWS1 form, it's really important to remember, is a lending document. We're all concerned about building safety. We all want the buildings to be safe. The EWS1 just confirms whether costs are required for remediation works or not. And that's very important for lenders. If we remove the EWS1 form, then we would go back to a situation where lenders and surveyors were having to try and interpret single building assessments or fire risk assessments or PAS 9980 assessments and decide whether a building required work or not, which we don't want to go back to that. The really great thing about the EWS1 form is it's binary. It's yes, it requires work, or no, it doesn't. So any replacement of that purely from a lender's point of view and from a valuation point of view would need to replicate that situation where you know clearly, yes, costs are required to fix this building, or no, they're not. And one other comment I'd like to make, going back a little bit to the FIA register. The issue with the FIA register of EWS1 forms is that it wasn't compulsory. So it didn't hold all the forms that were created.
Okay, thank you. Mervyn?
Mervyn,
want to come
in? Just to say, PAS 9980 is a highly regarded standard, right? And it's something that is helping. At the risk of saying the same thing over and over, it doesn't go. It's important for life safety, but it doesn't go as far as property resilience. So, whilst we think PAS 9980 has made a big difference and it is moving forward in the right direction, you know, we're still thinking about how we would enhance that further in order to get insurance premiums down. So that's the only thing I wanted to add there at this point.
Okay, that's very helpful. Thank you. Thanks, Kim.
Thanks, Willie. Just Mervyn on that, enhancing the PAS 9980. Yeah. What are your thoughts on that? What do we need to do?
So we need to, as I mentioned briefly earlier, so we're focusing on property resilience in addition to life safety. So the key concern for insurers is that obviously that everyone gets out safely. That's very important for everybody. But in terms of the potential cost to the insurer of the building being destroyed, it is much, much higher now than we previously thought. And so we're looking to get to standards that actually focus on that property resilience. And that takes into account, you know, all of the fire safety issues that we've talked about. You know, so it's not just about removing the cladding, although that's very, very important. But if you leave cladding or you leave combustible insulation in there and you haven't dealt with the fire breaks, then that's still a problem for fire safety issues, right? So there's a lot of issues around fire safety. If you remediate one and the others are still there, there's still the chance that building will be totally destroyed in a catastrophic fire. So that's the concern, is addressing all the issues.
Okay, yeah, that's very helpful. So it's kind of coming back to kind of the scope of the bill, but I think in the previous panel we were hearing that we need to move forward, but there needs to be an awareness that there needs to be more legislation brought forward to handle those other pieces or to look at the whole building. I'd like to bring in Miles Briggs with a question.
Thank you, Convener. Yeah, I wanted to touch upon professionals' insurance liability as well, because witnesses have told our committee that the cost and availability of professional indemnity insurance for building professionals, industry professionals involved in this work continues to be a significant issue. So just wanted to ask, why does this continue to be the case and how do you think that can be resolved?
So certainly PII insurance has been affected by the Grenfell tragedy and the loss of confidence in previous building regulations. But our understanding from talking to our members is that PII cover does remain available. And it does remain available for people to purchase. And particularly, we understand that qualified fire safety engineers are able to purchase that cover and carry out the cladding inspection work. So it's still available. It's available to purchase. And we understand that people are buying that cover. But it has been impacted, of course, by the loss of confidence from previous regulation issues.
Yeah. Thanks for that. I don't know if anyone else wants to add, is there specific products, given the workforce which will emerge, which have been developed in Scotland around this, do you know?
I'm not aware of any specific products at this point in time, but what we're seeing in England is that if there are fire risk assessors doing this work, then there is cover being able to be purchased. So there's no reason why that cover shouldn't be available in Scotland as well.
Thank you. Thanks, Karina.
Thanks, Miles. And now I'm going to bring in Stephanie Callaghan.
Thank you very much, convener. Some of this has been touched on, but clarity is always good. And ABI and Finance UK said in the written evidence they were asking for the bill to focus not just on the preservation of life, also the protection of property. And Meryl, you've just spoken about property resilience to prevent total loss there. Someone done, are there other justifications for this change, or is it about the potential cost for insurers only? And also, what the implications around the cost and timescales for remediation work might be?
So from an insurance perspective, it is about insurance costs, right? So if the expected loss of an insurer is higher, then the premiums will be higher. And the feeling is at the moment is that without building resilience standards, then the potential loss, the expected loss of the building, if it is subject to a catastrophic loss, is high, and therefore premiums are higher. So it is very much linked to the cost of insurance premiums. From an insurance perspective, it's about making sure that the building is protected in the various ways I've already mentioned, you know, in terms of insulation, fire breaks, cladding, etc., in a way that stops the building from being completely destroyed or severely damaged. You know, there are other elements to that as well. If a building is damaged, obviously, not only do you have the cost of the building itself, but people will need to be rehoused, etc. And obviously, it takes longer to rebuild a whole building than it does to repair the damage for individual units within a building. So that's the key issue there. In terms of your second part of your question as to whether this would slow things down, we've said already that we think PAS 980 has moved in the right direction, and it is a good point as we move forward. But I do think that over time we need to think about how we enhance PAS 980 so that we can get to this building resilience, and that would be the piece that actually ultimately brings down the premiums. Now, I should say at this point that we shouldn't be looking to see insurance premiums going down to where they were pre-Grenfell. A lot of things have happened since then, not least inflation. So I just want to make sure that people are aware that you know, insurance premiums would have gone up in that period in any case due to inflation. But I'm focusing here on the impact on premiums because of the expected loss being higher.
Okay. I don't know if you would have anything to add to that, John, and if there are different views as well from any others, I'd be interested to hear those.
I mean, just picking up the points there that Mervyn has made about rising insurance costs. So the issue in terms of how it plays out for mortgage lenders is really about it being a requirement essentially of all mortgages that the building is insured for all the standard perils, obviously including fire and destruction. And if the cost of that insurance continues to be high, then that will affect the affordability of a mortgage for a borrower, and it will also affect the loan to value, the LTV that a lender might be prepared to offer a customer on that property. So it's really from that perspective that the interest from mortgage lenders in insurance costs come. But clearly, you know, we do recognise that if, as a result of a significant fire event, the building is destroyed, then that essentially means that the lender's physical security for the loan is lost. However, that's why we have buildings insurance in place. And so it kind of comes round again, but essentially high insurance costs in terms of premium or excesses will impact borrower affordability or the LTV that they're able to get.
So any concerns then around the costs and timescales for remediation work?
Well, I think clearly everyone wants these problems to be fixed sooner rather than later. There are going to be factors at play in the market, the labour industry, access to materials and professional services that will impact the overall timescale for delivery of typical remediation programmes. And we will have to, live with that, really. If it can be accelerated and brought forward, then costs might come down sooner. But we just don't know how long it's going to take for each individual building to go through its remediation journey.
You've got a couple more questions, yeah.
Yep, just one more question, actually. Thanks, Convener. I know when the Law Society put in their written evidence, they were keen to see that there was greater detail was included in the bill around responsible developer scheme and the cladding assurance register. And I'm just wondering if you want to say a bit more on that, anything about risks, and mention any specific recommendations that you would like to see the committee bring forward, for example, to the government.
Okay. In relation to the responsible developer scheme, it's just a point of principle, which is that there's not a lot of detail actually contained in the bill. For example, the nature of the connection is open-ended and is left to, I think, secondary legislation. And so the question has been, do you think the RDS will work? And the answer is it's hard to say how it will work without that detail. So I think we have no specific recommendations for specific revisals to the bill. It is more of a general comment that it is difficult to assess how it will work in the absence of this detail. In relation to the cladding register, we have already commented on our view that the more information that is contained on that register at as early a point in time as possible, the better for making sure that everyone in the market has the same information. But also we would be keen to see a register of cleared buildings that fell out with the scope of the SPA to avoid basically the inefficiency of the same question being asked, investigated and answered on multiple occasions, where there should be the same answer is reached each time.
And I'm just wondering, do you have any reflections then on some of the comments that were made by the earlier panel today around having that flexibility rather than having to go back and actually change primary legislation using the secondary legislation? Just interested in what your thoughts on that might be.
I'm conscious that a number of points in our consultation response, we were keen to see more detail. And that's just a natural position of people who will be asked, what does this bill mean? How does it operate? And it's not possible to really answer a large number of questions without that detail. However, we also recognise that there is a need for flexibility. And I think the difficulty that I think all of us witnesses and Hollywood have is how do you balance the need for flexibility against certainty, against consistency, against speed of legislation. Basically, that's why I'm very, very glad that I'm on this seat rather than some of the other seats.
I think you sum it up very, very well there, John. Thank you, Convener.
Thanks, Stephanie. I just saw John Maher. I wanted to come in on that.
To agree with John on that, that it's essentially a question of balance, but also just to reflect on the experience which some witnesses in the earlier session this morning commented on with the Building Safety Act in England, which is a mammoth piece of legislation of immense complexity, with a great deal of detail on that primary legislation. And the experience has been that aspects of that have been problematic and have required subsequent reworking. So it does underline the need to, as John says, get the balance right as far as possible, because I think clearly there's the scope for things to be further delayed if any legislation which is passed by the Parliament here has to come back for reworking rather than being taken through the secondary legislation route.
Okay. Yeah, thanks for that kind of perspective. I've got one final question, which is around Do you think there's sufficient qualified fire engineers, surveyors and other building industry professionals and contractors in Scotland to undertake a single building assessment and cladding remediation within a reasonable timescale? And if not, how might any shortfall be tackled? So I'd be interested to hear your perspective on that.
Perhaps on that, convener, if I could really just reflect the views of fire professionals and other witnesses in the earlier session, indicating that given the numbers of buildings that may require work, there could be a shortfall in professionals north of the border. However, beyond that, I couldn't really comment. It's not a space which we operate in as UK Finance, but obviously our concern would be that there should be enough people to do this. And if there aren't, then that really is a concern about the prospect for further delaying buildings being fixed and further delaying the people who live in them to be able to get on with their lives, to buy and sell, to remortgage and to move on.
Thanks. Anybody else? John Sinclair?
Really to reiterate or agree with what John Marr said and to highlight that the value and quality of the register will be underpinned by the confidence the public have in the register. And that will be that will depend upon having a high degree of confidence in the people who are preparing the single building assessment, but also the process for signing off on completion of works. And so the availability and quality, the right quality, the right competencies of people involved in the single building assessment is critical. Madam Convener, can I return indirectly to one previous point, which is about flexibility and speed? One of the issues in the bill that is of concern to us, and I think it is driven by the need for speed and rapidly as possible, proceeding with works to buildings. But in the provisions relating to an appeal against works, there is a provision which provides that if an appeal to the sheriff is not determined within 21 days, then that appeal is deemed to be dismissed. And whilst we understand and appreciate the need for speed and certainty of process, that provision seems to us to be awkward.
I'm glad you brought that up, because when I read that in the papers, I thought that seems like it's quite tight. And what would be, if it wasn't an urgent situation, what would be, is there a kind of more a usual time frame for that kind of appeal process?
Our concern wasn't actually with the time frame.
Okay.
Albeit an appeal against a proposal for works could be very, very complicated. The concern we have is more the principle that an individual could be effectively deprived of their right to an appeal by a delay within the process.
Okay. And is there another way around that? Maybe you need to write to us.
I think there isn't another way. It will come down to the court rules and the process of managing the appeal.
Right.
I think the position could perhaps be ameliorated in greater clarity as to what is the trigger for the appeal and when that appeal would then occur. I think from memory that the terms of the bill are that the notice that would be appealed would be the notice that is given by the Scottish ministers once works have been arranged, or they have arranged to carry out the works. And I think it's understanding what is meant by that. Is that basically they have a building contract that they have signed, or they have a set of tenders that they're about to put forward, or do they have a rough set of works, they know what they want to do, but they haven't specified it in detail or costed it. It sort of comes back to the earlier point about the process between a single building assessment to the report, to the specification, to the building warrant, to the contract for the construction of the works, and perhaps greater clarity as to the point at which that appeal would be triggered might be one route for reducing the potential for a very late stage delay and disruption in the process. Mm.
Okay, I think that's very helpful, actually, and I would actually just open that up in general in terms of, is there anything that's missing in the bill from your perspective Anybody else? Ask that question to anybody else? No? Okay. Miles, you wanted to come in with a brief supplementary.
Specific point with regards to at the heart of this are individual householders, the stress and anxiety they've felt, but it has been raised with us as we go through this process, orphan buildings, what's done with those, and where the insurance industry maybe are treating those different. So just wondered, as we go through this process and the 100 and odd buildings here in Scotland, which are currently going to be looked at, where is industry with regards to these buildings and making sure that there's specific solutions found? Marvin, I'll maybe bring you in to start on that.
Yeah, I mean, when you say orphan buildings, I'm assuming you're meaning individual buildings that are not linked to any other developments. Is that right? Just to be clear.
Or where developers cease to exist.
I mean, so again, I guess insurers are providing cover for buildings. They're not. They haven't not provided cover, but of course the cost is higher when the remediation haven't happened. Our members can help owners to understand what remediation might be required. But obviously, then it's a question of how they fund that, right? And that's a very difficult, very, very difficult position to be in, right? So, and I'm not sure it's for us to be. Helping them with the remediation cost, but certainly we can have discussions with them as to how, you know, what might be required in order to get premiums down if we're not dealing, you know, with developers who are currently in existence.
And I think my specific concern would be we create a two-tier system where we say, and potentially where they go on the register, that we say, well, a developer is going to do this work, it's agreed, public funds are also available, but then we have a group of orphan ones. And workforce-wise, all the workforce goes to where developers are orchestrating that work. And then insurance premiums increase for people, and these properties are seen in a different category. So we need to make sure we don't leave them left for someone to then look at doing that work going forward.
As you probably know, in England, that there has been funding, some government funding for some of these buildings, right? And maybe that's a way to work forward is to focus government funding on those buildings where the developers don't have, you know, there are no developers or they're no longer in existence in order to solve some of those issues as we move forward.
Mm-hmm. But importantly, I suppose, the insurance industry to understand this need as well.
Obviously we should definitely understand the need, but you know, and when there's not a desire to have buildings being treated differently, but at the same time we obviously have to make sure that there's remediation plans in place so that we can move forward with reducing premiums. But the one thing maybe I should add that which we haven't mentioned at all on this call as yet is that we have been developing a reinsurance facility, right, which is aiming to try and get premiums down. We would expect there to be a plan for remediation for buildings placed in that facility, but we're very hopeful that facility will be announced soon, and that would apply to buildings in Scotland in the same way as it would apply to buildings in England.
That's helpful. Thanks, Karina.
Yeah, thanks very much. Yeah, I'm sure that's heartening news for people who own the buildings. Yeah, Dunmar.
So thank you. Just picking up on that as well. Certainly, as Mervyn mentioned, there are public funds available to support the remediation of so-called orphan buildings in England and also in Wales as well. And if that's not something which has been considered here in Scotland, then it might be something that MSPs might want to think about in terms of directing public funds to those buildings where a developer cannot be identified or held to account.
Okay, great. Thank you very much. Well, that actually concludes our questions. I think it's been yet another very helpful panel this morning, certainly getting a much clearer picture of all the different permutations and how do we make this a good piece of legislation that's going to meet the needs. It's quite challenging, but I think it's really been good to hear from you. We previously agreed to take the next three items in private, so as that was the last public item on our agenda today, I now close the public part of the meeting.